Deep Six from Marilyn Manson, and big, huge surprise. That was Mars picking that song. What? You like Marilyn Manson?
Yes, I do.
Did you ever expect Mars to like Marilyn Manson, Jim Norton?
You know, Mars is an odd duck, as we say. So I'm not necessarily surprised, but every time I hear a new Marilyn Manson song, but God damn, that's good. I love him so.
He's got good stuff.
Yeah, I'm never surprised when someone likes Manson.
Song's a bit old. Right?
Yeah, came out January.
January? I was telling Travis I'm out as far as Marilyn Manson goes. I'm behind.
Is that new video? There's a new video for that one? It's like a black and white video that Michael K. Williams is in?
So, yes. Yeah.
Yeah, Omar's in that video.
Yeah, I was checking it out on YouTube just to familiarize myself with the new song. I love Marilyn Manson, mm-hmm. but for some reason I haven't, you know, paid attention that much in the last few years.
The whole Pale Emperor album is great.
Yeah.
Every song.
Marilyn Manson, really?
Yes.
I thought you were like a Herb Albert guy.
Surprise.
You grew up with metal?
A little bit, yeah. I grew up with Floyd. And
not that Marilyn Manson is like, you know, pure metal, but right. He's got a little of it in there.
Dude is talented.
Definitely.
Oh, well, no one talented. Would deny that.
Yeah.
Who else did you like growing up?
Pink Floyd, The Stones. I like The Beatles, Hendrix.
Yeah, you're a rock guy.
Yeah.
That's my brilliant conclusion.
I know.
That's the Mars list for rock legends. So you're a rock guy.
You know, you only break out that question every once in a while because you think the person's going to pick some unique bands.
Right.
He picked the four most basic bands ever.
Yeah. The gold standard of bands.
The gold standard of bands, right.
Can't go wrong with those.
Because it really is a hack question, but you only save it to like Sherrod.
Yeah.
Who did you grow up listening to?
I grew up listening to Pink Floyd, The Beatles, Rolling Stones. You know, the gold standards.
Then you look like a fool for asking the question. Well, thank you, Mars.
We would expect Mars is Puerto Rican. We would have expected like Latin music. That's it.
No, but Puerto Ricans like metal, though.
Oh, I know. Oh, I mean, like when you ask a guy, you're just expecting them to go like, "Oh, I like this," or you know, whatever. I can't name any Latin bands.
Who's Vida Loca? Who's that dude? Ricky Martin.
Oh, Ricky Martin.
Yeah, we would assume you're a Ricky
Mars
Martin
is 54. He's not a Ricky Martin fan.
It's not that surprising because like rock is huge, like in South America.
Oh, yeah,
like,
it's true.
Rock and Rio festival, and, like Guns and Roses.
All right, Sepultura. I would have thought that he liked
Mars like Sepultura.
Yeah, there you go.
There's also Puya, right?
See, I don't know that. That's really
that's metal.
You're talking.
Okay. Puya.
Yeah.
What was that?
Very heavy metal.
None of that reggaeton.
I get into some of that too.
It's a Sherrod thing.
Reggaeton.
It's a Sherrod thing.
Every time you say it, I feel like I'm on my bike up in like 145th.
That's why I say it. We go on the same bike route. We haven't done it together yet.
Yeah,
maybe that'll be a little too gay, but I still want to go for a ride.
We should, yeah. We're
not even gay about bike riding unless you take the seats off.
Not when you're like, not when you text a dude like, "Hey, you want to go for a bike ride?" But if I happen to run into Sherrod, then I'm like, "All right, let's go uptown,
right? Yeah,
along the river, and then ride through the reggaeton area."
I think the planning of it is the gay part.
They have so much fun. Yeah. Have you ever hung out at the reggaeton area?
Right where the baseball parks are up there.
Well, I'm from the Heights, so I know that whole area.
It's near
the,
yeah.
Down by the river.
As a matter of fact, I'll be going to, I believe,
shot my baby.
What? I'll be going to Dinosaurs this weekend.
Oh, barbecue?
Yeah.
All right,
125th.
Yeah, we ride right by that.
They had a whole bunch of dinosaur barbecue in here the other day for Eminem, didn't they?
Yeah,
he took one bite and fucking rolling it up.
Is dinosaur barbecue the best?
Oh, yeah. It's up there.
It's fantastic.
Yeah. Where is it? 125th and what? I'll take a ride up to Harlem since I'm all the trains now. I'll hop the old subway up to Harlem.
We're going to have to walk down to the river after you take the subway. Down. It's right on the river.
Right on the river.
Oh. There's a couple little nice joints over there.
Oh, yeah. They got that little jazz place. Like
Jerry Seinfeld took Tina Fey to one of those joints for Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee.
They were both assaulted outside.
I wish.
They stole his Porsche.
I believe it has a little Latin fare. I think it has a little Latin spin on their food or something like that, if I remember correctly. But it's right near Dinosaur Jr. Yeah. Or Dinosaur Barbecue. Right. Thinking music still.
Do you know when we saw Metallica at the Apollo? James Hetfield was not at the meet and greet, which was one of those things that heartbreaking.
It was sad for
but
us.
But anyway,
I threw that picture away because James Hetfield's not in it.
I'm
really?
So heartbroken.
Yeah, because we were lucky enough to get a picture with the whole band and like, oh, James is Jimmy.
A dinosaur barbecue.
Yeah. Oh, he
that's where he was with his kids or whatever. He was doing a family thing.
Oh yeah, it's good food.
But you know, we're bummed. We're like, this picture is missing something.
But you're the singer,
right?
James, you're the singer.
You always want the singer in your picture, right?
right? Otherwise, it's useless.
I mean, the lead guitarist, if he's not in the picture, you're going to deal with that.
It's
more than flick. More than if the lead singer's out.
Yeah.
But so if you know where Dinosaur Barbecue is, you go a little more north of there, and that's where the reggaeton area is.
Yeah, right. A little more north. Oh, you always see that lady out there who had, like, the Frank stand, but she's cooking Spanish food.
Of
somehow.
Course.
It's like, how do you cook Spanish food at a Frank fucking... She's a pro.
I get excited because I go up to her and I go, agua. I use a little of my Spanish.
Ooh.
I go agua, and sometimes I go frio.
Ooh. I go, whoa.
Yes, and she rolls her eyes like, I know English too, you asshole.
Yes. I just roll right by and yell Telemundo right in the face.
You got to be careful, though, man, because all of a sudden those kids come running out. You hit a kid up there with your bike, you're fucked. They're going to throw you in the river, you and your bike.
And they come running out of behind dumpsters and everything.
Yes, I think they're doing it on purpose. Yes. I think their father's right behind. They're like, okay, all the rich assholes are biking up.
They get
here.
Out of my way, but when white people come through, there's 30 kids right in front of the bike.
Right.
Are they looking for a payday?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, I think they might
be. I think somebody is.
Because, I mean, there are guys rolling through there with those fucking $10,000 bikes easily.
And those kids dart through there.
And they just come running in front of you, and they're looking for a payday.
Oh, wow.
They see me and they go like this, they ain't got nothing. Get out the way.
They know how to have a good time up there.
Oh, yes, they party all summer. Right now. Like, to this weekend, it's going to be packed in there.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to be 19 baseball games going on. Everybody could have went pro.
Yes. On the shitty fields. I know we've done this bit, and I apologize, but
It's impressive.
I look the other way, like, all right, I do know what really is going on in this city.
What?
They have beautiful uniforms because they take their baseball very seriously. They got leagues up there, and the grass is shitty, and the dirt is shitty, and it has rocks. And
them motherfuckers be hitting that ball.
When you ride by, you're pretty much riding by right field.
Yeah.
And you can't see home plate because the grass is so high. You know there's a problem.
It's like
city.
Leopards jumping out from out the grass.
And then where I live, it's the fields are beautiful. It almost you almost feel like you're looking at Yankee Stadium itself.
You got lights and everything down there.
Yeah, and no one is playing on them. Nobody. Yeah. And then you go up to this area, and there's teams just waiting for hours to get on the field.
Yes,
they just line up to play on the shitty field.
It's funny how you can tell where the Dominicans are up there, and then it's a switch, and it's the South Americans, like up there by where they just rebuilt everything, like the playgrounds and the volleyball.
Yes,
and that's all South American dudes up there.
Okay,
that's not Dominicans.
It changes into soccer, right? Over
yes,
there?
They don't mix it up.
Yeah, yeah. It goes from baseball to soccer.
Yes,
and then that weird volleyball game that I'm still trying to figure out. It's not like traditional volleyball. The courts are small.
It's small courts. It's like a. It's
and
like
you can play in your jeans and shit. I don't know.
They go hard. They go hard. They play in jeans, no jeans, and then they go back to their delivery job. Full sweated.
But I think the ball could bounce. Or I don't know. I stopped once to try to figure it out.
When you said it, it's not as like volleyball where you got to hit it. You can actually like grab and push it. It's more push than a hit.
Yeah. But is that a real sport?
I think so.
It is. Okay.
And then if you go further north, then you're back to Lily White Tennis Courts in Washington Park.
And that's all black dudes teaching tennis. You've seen that, right?
That sounds like a new show.
With the little white girls.
Oh, yeah, during the day,
with their black tennis instructor.
We have that in the building, the guy who was with a swim instructor was a black guy. And I think that there was a poll taken, and he was voted in best shape in the country.
His body's unbelievable?
The guy was he was literally a statue. And it was so funny. He would be teaching these little white girls, and he had like long dreadlocks that were tied. And I'm just watching these white moms, and I'm like, these moms, he could literally drown their kids, and they would still sit there giggling and looking at his abs. I'm like, they just want to fucking be around this guy. That's all
that
it is.
He was
one of those guys. He's just the guy. You know, some people just are built perfect. He was like one of those guys.
Yeah.
And it was always a white mom in there with the kid while he would teach her, and these guys laughing and having fun. I'm like, this mom wants to have him cream her fucking box out. She wants him to knock her pussy through the mattress.
They don't give a fuck if their kid ever learns how to swim.
Not at all. Where's the kid face down in the pool an hour later? Oh, no.
But they're down there every Tuesday at 1 o'clock for their kids' swimming lessons.
Getting swimming lessons.
Oh, that's funny.
But I also watch, and again, it's totally professional. But whenever you watch someone give a kid swim lessons, like they have to hold the kid under the stomach.
I can do it. I couldn't do it.
Doesn't it just seem like as a parent, you go, hey.
Yeah, yeah. Oh, yeah. You don't want anyone touching your kids.
But it's totally, that's how you teach,
right? I know, that's how you got to teach them, but.
Yeah. If they had clothes on, I wouldn't have been as uncomfortable. I was like, why are they both nude? This is odd.
There's nothing more awkward than touching a fucking kid.
Yeah.
Definitely if it's not yours.
You can touch kids. Bill Burr has that great bit where a kid needed help in an elevator or something, and he just couldn't, touch him.
Yeah.
Because you're scared that the kid's going to start yelling something crazy.
Yeah.
You've got to be careful with that shit. Kids.
Yeah.
Maybe we can find the bit.
Cause... Even your own kid. I always say that. Even changing my daughter's diaper was like, ugh.
Why?
Fuck. Because you, first of all, you got to take the diaper off, right? And then you got to wipe her. So if you don't wipe hard enough, she's going to have a rash or something. You wipe too hard, you're molesting her.
Right.
So you got to find the balance.
Yeah.
It's up to you to find the balance.
That's the one thing about being a father. I'm cleaning out a vagina every day. What?
Luckily, my daughter would be like this. Too hard.
She gave
me the heads. I'm like, well, okay, that's good. Okay, thank you. I was like, you're the best.
You're doing it too hard probably too because as a dad, the last thing you want to do is touch your daughter's vagina.
It's strange,
in any way
man.
That could be considered sensual.
Yes.
So you're roughing it up. Open that little thing up. Clean. Get the hose. Like... It's got to be completely mechanical the way you'd wash a boy's hair if fucking he had like poison ivy in it. Terrible example, Jim. Good improv. Poison ivy in the hair.
It is weird though. You got to get in there.
Or they got a rash. They
especially
get a rash.
When they're a lot younger, there's poo everywhere. So the poo's getting into the vagina.
Yes.
So you're like, what?
I'm
actually opening it up a little bit to get what?
Yes. And it's uncomfortable.
What the fuck is this?
It's uncomfortable.
It's strange.
It's the weirdest. That's the hardest.
My son with his penis all day long. No big deal. Fucking lift up those balls and get rid of the poo.
You can splash a cup of coffee on a penis and it's fine.
Yeah.
It's but vagina is a fucking fearful mess. I've always had fear of it.
You really could put your penis through the ringer. No problem.
Yes. Yeah.
No problem.
Cleaning a dick's a lot easier. Well, if the kid had foreskin, it might be harder. Like,
yeah.
I wouldn't want to do that.
Yeah.
Like, I've been told about circumcision a lot. I'm like, I don't know if I would find a son, but maybe I would just find them to clean it.
Yeah. I didn't think about that.
So my kid was circumcised. Was he yelling and screaming at the hospital?
I don't know what the numbing is there. It's different. I don't know.
Is it different than what you witnessed when you went through that?
I hope so. That was brutal.
The numbing is just a topical numb, right? It's not like they give them the medicine.
Yeah, it was almost like a Neosporin. So it was really nothing. It was nothing.
I think it's the next day or something when your kid's born, they do it.
Yeah.
But I believe.
It was a guttural. Fuck it. It was literally like some out of a horror movie. It scarred me emotionally.
What were you talking about when you?
I went to Noam's Bris, his son Bris. And again, it was part of their religion. It wasn't a hardcore. It wasn't like those moils, the ones we talked about yesterday that sucked up. Well, it wasn't that. It was just it's the ritual of it.
Right.
And I've had it done, and you guys have had it done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it's like I guess that I had just never seen it.
Yeah, I've never seen it.
I've never watched it.
Only on tape, not in person.
Yeah. Yeah, it's one of those things you rent and you watch for the weekend with some friends.
We were watching them suck fucking baby penis yesterday on the internet.
What?
Oh, the
remember that sign I texted you?
Some of the kids were getting herpes.
That's a big problem in Brooklyn.
And a couple kids died from the herpes.
What?
Yeah, and then someone tried to defend it, saying, look, all the, there's the numbers are, they're doing it, it's safe for most, I guess, is what I'm trying to say.
Why are they sucking on baby dicks anyway?
It's part of their religion.
To suck a baby dick?
No, to get the blood out.
To suck the blood out.
Yeah.
Some nonsense.
It's not a new religion. It's a hard, one of those hardcore religions.
But is this something that they have to do before, like, we had the, like...
It's probably
equipment to clean it properly.
Yes, it probably started as a hygiene thing.
But then someone probably said, no, we got to keep tradition. We're not using the new tools of society.
Nothing else tastes so good.
Yeah, exactly. It was probably, It was probably when it started doing it in certain areas.
Yeah.
There'd be dust and dirt.
Yeah.
And the only way to clean the tip would be like, and spit it out to make sure it was clean.
But nowadays, you got things that can do that. You got Purell, motherfucker. Yeah. You ain't got to suck a baby dick.
You have a sink. Hold the little fucker under a sink.
And rinse him.
Nice warm water over his dick and balls will probably feel good after a fucking butchering.
Ooh, is video of it online?
Oh,
you don't see the whole thing. But
I don't.
No, it's uncomfortable.
You've seen it.
No, I never saw a grown man suck a baby dick. I've seen a lot of things.
Okay. Yes. Actually, they had Shrod likes him a 10 and up.
Yes, like, at least.
They pretty much had it on the news, but
The story was, but they didn't have video.
Yeah, they did.
What?
The back of the guy's
head. I mean, it wasn't like a detailed video, but you see the back of the guy's head as he's going in. as he's going in.
And then the baby pushed the back of his head. Get in there. Yeah. That'd be great.
The rabbi explains the importance of orally sucking blood from...
all right, can we hear him?
All right.
I'd love to talk to
you. Sure, okay.
I thought it was a call.
Oh, no. This was...
Well, he's just...
Live Leak had it.
Wow.
Yeah,
how
push
do you justify that?
Your religion.
Religion is evil.
Because the saliva will mix with...
In the halacha, in Yoredeya, that's the second section of the four sections of halacha called the Shulchan Aruch, the set table, in chapter 266, halacha 3, 4, 5, and 6, he describes how the circumcision is to be done. He says, after the cutting, the mohel does what is called metzitza, and metzitza means to suck, and it means doing so with his mouth. Yeah, I want to say, well, why can't you use a tube? Well, you could, technically, but it's not the custom as to why, how it's done.
That's disgusting. The custom is like that because it was 1,000 years ago, fucking asshole.
Yeah. So basically, the
guy who came up with this 1,000 years ago might have, I don't know, been a pedophile.
Could have been.
And said, holy fuck, I have figured some shit out for
Dick
myself.
Dick is delicious.
Or imagine if that guy could come back and talk to him and go, you have tubes and you're still doing that? I had to do that. There was nothing. It was the desert. You have tubes and you're still doing it?
That's the angle. Yes.
What's the matter with you?
It's too much.
Well, in page... I know what it says. I wrote it.
I was living in a cave back then.
Exactly.
And I
specifically,
I wrote, if you can have access to a tube, use it. And my editor thought they was too long.
Oh, God. Customs and traditions get ridiculous.
They're the worst.
You got to let them go, man. You can't.
I think you're right. But, I mean, that's never going to happen, though. You want to? I guess that's it, right?
It's 1,000 years ago when that dude did that.
Yeah. Oh, easily. Didn't you say that?
I said the same thing about eating pig, eating pork. It's like, yeah, it wasn't clean 1,000 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
Now we got different ways of cleaning it.
Was that the real reason?
Because they said it was filthy animal.
Yeah.
Pork tastes goddamn good.
Man, I challenge you to find something that tastes
bacon
better.
Bacon is good.
Just
pork chops are good.
Don't let me see the head and the tail next time and the hooves.
But what about that cheek meat? You don't want the cheek meat?
Oh, God, no. You were here for the pig roast.
Oh, yes.
Discussion, okay.
I love that cheek meat, baby. That's that good meat. That's good eating.
I openly admitted I was a fucking pussy. And then fucking people start tweeting me pictures of lambs.
Oh, yeah.
Did you see the lamb pictures?
Oh, was it split open?
Yeah. They roast the lamb right in front of the party.
Wow. No, I didn't see that.
Ah, man, I'm a fucking pussy.
I would love that.
All of a sudden, pig tasted disgusting when I saw the head and the hooves and the tail.
Ah, that's my favorite parts.
To see it?
Yeah.
I know what they do to the animals. I'm not dumb, but I just don't want to see it.
You had pig feet before, right?
I've never had pig feet, no.
How white are you, OP?
He is a fucking...
He's northerly white.
And yes, he is.
And I was poor, too. I should have been eating pig feet.
You probably had Spam, though. Spam was your pig feet.
I ate Spam.
There you go. That's pig feet in there. His feet all grinded up in there.
What is Spam?
It's a pork shoulder.
It is?
Yeah.
Spam.
How'd they get it into email? That's a miracle.
They just mushed it. They just mushed it.
They mushed it into
your hard drive.
Yeah, that got the soldiers through World War II.
Spam is stupid.
They said it won the war.
Because we figured out how to get these guys some
canned meat, yeah. That was the number one thing other soldiers wanted when they ran into American soldiers in World War II. It's like, do you have Spam?
Yeah. I think the bombs had something to do with that, too.
Yeah.
That's why it's huge in Hawaii,
Maybe Spam's number two there.
Yeah, Spam's number two behind Little Boy. And yeah. What was the other one called? Was it Big Boy and Little Boy? I think so.
Oh, yeah.
I think that was the number one reason we won the war.
Maybe.
And then Spam will give number two.
Food's important.
What's number three?
Logistics. Russian winter.
Russian winter
was killed Hitler.
That's right. I forgot about the Russian winter.
Yeah.
Got to go back to your history class.
Yeah.
All right. We got Daniel Bryan coming in a little while. He's a big, big star in that WWE.
Oh, yeah.
He's the yes guy.
Yes.
Yes.
He's married to one of those Bella twins.
He's got Diva as a wife, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Diva?
Yes. 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 I want to go on record and say I didn't watch Sharknado 3, even though I'm supposed to.
Where was it?
Because we have Ian Ziering coming in today.
I saw some of it last night. Now, David Hasselhoff was in it, too.
You DVR'd it.
Well, they played it, replayed it late.
Oh, fuck. I can't stay up that late. How do you do that?
Has it been replayed already? I haven't seen it.
I went to bed like 3 in the morning, buddy. Yeah.
I checked out a little Race Wars. You guys killed it last night.
Thank you, sir.
Bonnie was on, and then Rich Voss had to decide he had to come on because Bonnie was here. You booked Bonnie, but Rich
just showed up. Yes.
Let Bonnie do her thing solo.
You know Voss.
I like the Rich Voss. Trust me, I like the Rich Voss, but let Bonnie have a little solo.
Let her breathe. Yeah, I reckon so.
But he was good, too.
He killed it.
Yeah, the show was great last night. Yeah,
we had fun. We had Yamanika Saunders and Bonnie and Rich.
All right.
We had a little, you know, crew in here. Had some people from Fox News.
Really?
Yeah, had one of the you know, on-air personalities, Lauren Coles. You know Lauren Lyons Cole.
I don't know her by name. I'm sure by face.
Yeah, let's take a look at her.
Carolyn Waxler came in from VH1. One of the producers from Best We Got when she came in.
You know a lot of stars there, Sharad.
Yeah, I reckon so.
We actually invite you in just because Dash is coming in.
Yes.
And I heard you're friends with Dash.
We hung out a couple times.
Or did a show with him?
Well, we hung out a couple times on Up East Side when I was on 75th Street. We used to hang at American Trash.
Okay.
And he raps, too. That's why y'all don't know about him, that he's a rapper.
I really did not know that.
Yeah, he's got like 3 albums. Kind of.
But he's coming like in. That. He's on Ray Donovan.
Ray Donovan, yeah.
He plays Bunchy on Ray Donovan.
Ray's younger brother who was molested.
They all got fumbled with Ray, too.
Oh, yeah, they all did. That's true. John Voight tonight is a real prick.
Oh, he's great. He was born for that role.
Wendell Pierce is in it now from Bunk from The Wire has a role in
it. Oh, yeah, yeah. That's right, yeah.
And isn't Tom Cruise's ex in it, too, right?
Oh, she just started this season.
Oh, did she?
Yeah.
Katie Holmes?
Katie Holmes. She's in a couple of episodes this season.
Looking all hot and shit.
She was looking sexy. This is the sexiest episode. I actually see her sometimes with her daughter when Alexa in, like, 60s.
I saw her once with the daughter, and the daughter was acting up.
Was she?
And then I felt so bad for her because everyone was, like, just popping up their cameras like, holy shit, we might have the video.
She's acting up.
Ass. Look, man, I mean... I'm a father, so it could have just been a bad day for the kid.
Right.
But if the kid is acting like that every day, wow, she's got her hands full. Full tantrums.
Really?
Full tantrums in front of a lot of people that are recognizing her.
I would have tore her.
Recognizing Katie Holmes.
Up.
And Katie's like sitting there like, holy fuck, you're doing this now while everyone is recognizing us and popping up their cameras because they just want a picture of the celebrity walking the street right now.
And her daughter's acting an ass.
And then, like, Katie Holmes went into one of these stores to kind of get away from everybody. She figured that was her move to get the kid off the street.
Yeah.
And everyone just followed her into the store.
Oh.
That's real. That is real fame right there.
Did she have security with her?
Nope.
When I saw it, she didn't have security either.
And then the kid is acting up in the store.
I'm going to start dating her.
I knew because I was looking through the window, by the way. I didn't go into the actual store, but I was still taking a peek.
He's on a glass like this.
Oh, yeah. Oh, before
I was
on an application.
Of taking a peek.
It's so embarrassing. Kids can really embarrass you.
Yeah, I was guilty, but I didn't go all in. I didn't go following her into the store or nothing. And I never... And I have no problem popping my camera on. No problem. But for some reason I didn't. I was like, wow, this is too bad. This is too weird.
Because that could have been any of us.
Just a lady with her kid. She's acting like a shit. It's like, yes.
That kid's spoiled too. You can tell from a distance.
That's sort of what I'm getting at. But like I said, you know, I got to be fair because I am a parent. It might just have been a bad day. But I got the impression that the kid might be a bit spoiled.
I'm sure she'd give Tom Cruise some hell too. He said he feels like a stranger around it now. Did you hear that?
Oh, really?
No. Yeah. He said he don't get to see it enough.
But he probably was barely around.
Yeah.
Well, they're probably keeping him away from fucking Scientology.
Yeah.
That's probably what it is. She's probably like, I'm not letting you take her to that dumb Sea Org so the kid can run around with a captain's hat on. It's not happening. Stop it.
The kid can't go clear?
Yeah, exactly. No, she's probably like, no, she's had enough.
Yeah.
What was that part of Scientology again where they had to go on the boat?
That's the Sea Org.
And clean the
Sea
boat.
Org. Thank you.
Yeah.
Oh, God, is that funny.
That was...
I finally saw that documentary.
Yeah, it's very uncomfortable.
Oh,
it's
creepy.
And they're
calling out Tom Cruise like, you know what the fuck's going on here. You need to speak up.
Is he leaving the church?
People are being mistreated through this thing. I don't know. There were rumors about it.
There was a lot of bad rumors that there was bad treatment of people. But was he leaving? Yeah, I had heard that he might want to leave. But I mean, maybe they know stuff about him. I don't care what he does, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
But if he's not seeing his daughter, then he's just shitty.
What kind of church tells you secrets if you leave?
Exactly. What kind of church keeps, like, I mean, Catholicism, they all have secrets, but, like, the basic, the paperwork and stuff like that,
yeah.
It's a big secret.
And you gotta get everything out.
But isn't the confessional pretty similar to that? I mean, you're telling some pretty heavy secrets.
But they don't force your hand.
And they're not taping you.
How do you know?
That's true.
I bet you there's a few creepy priests over the years that absolutely taped it for, you know, for their own...
For spanking. Sure. Spanking
for
purposes.
Whatever they wanted to do with
but
it.
But it wasn't an organizational issue where they were keeping it because you're powerful. Right. They were keeping you in line with, you know, that was what the rumors were.
But I wonder if that make, you know, plays with your mind when you're thinking, you know, I want to leave the Catholic Church. And then you're like, oh, fuck, I admitted some shit in that.
But at least with the Catholic Church, you can say I go to another church.
Oh, right, yeah.
You know, the priests don't fucking follow you around.
Right.
Well, no.
But Scientology is like this, which location did you go to?
Yeah, that's good. That's a good
call
point.
Call us when you're there.
Good fucking point. I just want to acknowledge Uber this morning. Congratulations to Uber.
So they what? They're not going to cap
the drivers?
You know
the Uber thing, right?
Yeah. Yes, yes.
Fuck this city. Fuck our mayor.
Yes!
Are you you're not a de Blasio guy, are you?
I like de Blasio because he has a black lesbian wife, but this is I didn't want him capping the drivers on Uber. Because ethnicities can't get cabs to the fucking outer boroughs.
Not just that. If you just live in the outer boroughs in general, you can't get a cab.
Right. So that's true.
But basically, he wanted to put a cap on how many Uber drivers would be allowed to work in New York City and the surrounding boroughs. And, you know, obviously he's in bed with the TLC or something.
Yeah, they paid for a part of his, you know, campaign. What are you laughing about?
Just thought of a joke that could get me fired.
Oh, no. Wow, that's quick. That is fucking lightning quick.
You said he was in bed with the TLC.
Has something to do with Lisa Left Eye Lopez?
No.
Okay,
no,
that's
no,
the TLC.
No.
I was...
No, not that one.
And he had the vote to get it done, to limit the Uber drivers.
So what happened?
Then fucking, why am I cursing so much?
The mayor.
Then the Governor Cuomo stepped in. And Governor Cuomo is no fan of de Blasio.
No,
these guys go at it all the time.
Yeah.
And Governor Cuomo was able to kind of turn some people last minute or something like that and get the celebrities involved. And then they had a huge campaign on TV,
yes,
the Uber people.
Yes.
He lobbied directly to people that support de Blasio.
And they're saying in the paper today, even though de Blasio still had the vote, he's backing down from the heat.
Good.
He backed down from the heat.
It's like, what the fuck are you doing trying to take up for the TLC? Like, they look out for people. Stop.
Right.
Like, people got access to cars.
And the TLC, one minute, and then we'll get Daniel Bryan in here. The TLC had a huge fucking lead on this whole thing and just ignored this new technology.
Yes.
They could have kept Uber out by just being smarter.
And being nicer and being fucking more, you know.
How about just coming up with an app going, all right, hey, you need a cab. You could use the TLC app and, you know, we'll get you a cab as soon as we can.
Whoever's in power, they try to freeze technology because
right.
It ain't gonna. It bugs them.
Right.
It brings in competition.
And now those medallions are worth a lot less. That's
good.
The problem.
Good.
And a lot of these guys are gonna have to file bankruptcy because you can't compete with how convenient Uber is.
Uber's so convenient. They take you anywhere.
Why would you
pass you by in the street?
Why would you fucking
Samuel?
Why would you fucking push down new ways of doing things and new technology unless you're in bed with the people?
Exactly. You gonna stop progress, you son of a bitch? I thought you were a progressive fucking candidate.
Yeah, ridiculous.
Makes me angry.
So congratulations to Uber.
God bless them.
They won a biggie, man.
That's unbelievable.
I think it's like 4 months they're gonna study the traffic and what Uber is bringing to the city.
Amazing. I believe. They try to say that Uber was clogging the streets. It's like, no, they're not.
The cabs are already clogging the streets.
Speaking of Uber, our next guest is Uber popular.
Yay!
Daniel Bryan.
What a sag.
Are you talking to Sam Roberts or Daniel Bryan?
Sam Roberts is not a guest.
Yeah.
Sam Roberts, it's just a growth that is returning.
I didn't watch that Sharknado shit.
It was very similar to the
And I'm going to tell Ian to his face that I didn't watch that shit.
Good for you.
I'm going to say I'm done with your Sharknado movies.
So you miss David Hasselhoff being left on the moon? Is that what happened?
Yes,
saluting from the moon? Like he's victorious and he's left to die on the moon.
You know what? Now I wish I saw that.
It was great.
That's kind of funny.
And then Ian Ziering coming to the Earth in a shark. Now the shark ate him in space. Him and Tyra Reed. And they fell in... It was the whole thing.
Daniel Bryan.
Yes! 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 Yes!
Hey, guys.
What's up, brother? Good to see you, man.
I know you can't. I know you can't publicly say it, but you got to be sick of the yes thing. You have to be.
No. So it's not that I'm publicly, or it's not that I'm sick of it. It's just that it's like, It's weird when people sometimes do it. Like, somebody did it to me in a bathroom, like in an airport bathroom.
Oh, no.
And I'm literally urinating. And the guy's like, "Hey, Daniel Bryan, yes, yes, yes." And like,
at least he wasn't peeking over the stall going, "Yes, yeah, yeah, yes."
He wouldn't have done that. He would have been like, "Yeah."
But if he was peeking over and you get the yes, then you know.
That's kind of nice.
Yeah, you're doing all right. That would have been very affirmative.
You know you're doing all right. And it's at every sporting event now. Oh, my God.
Yeah, I mean, it's not at every sporting
event. It's at a lot of sporting events.
Yeah,
the Islanders like to do the yes, yes, yeah. Yes. My team likes to do the yes, yes, yes. So, and I heard it was Vince McMahon's idea. Is that true?
No.
All right.
That's what Vince McMahon said.
No. His
I will read what I got in front of me. He credits Vince McMahon with coming up with the yes phrase.
No. I credit Diego Sanchez, who's a UFC fighter, with coming up with the yes phrase. He would come to the ring and he would pound the cage and pound his fist and be like, "Yes, yes, yes." And I thought, wow, that's really good. And also kind of annoyingly heelish a little bit to some people. And when I had first won the World Heavyweight Championship, Vince had just wanted me to celebrate like I was the happiest man in the world. And that was his directive. So then my interpretation of that was screaming yes and throwing my hands in the air. It just stuck. Yeah, it just stuck.
You weren't sure it was going to work.
I didn't know. Like, yeah. I didn't start it thinking like it was going to be this thing. I never thought it was going to be a thing. I just did it and it was fun. And then I started seeing people do it. And then there was a big blow up moment where everybody started doing it. And then, yeah.
That's got to feel good.
Yeah. Wow, yeah. The lock on to something.
Yes is easy to say, too. That's a good one. If you're going to get one that you're kind of stuck with, yes is a good one.
Not only that, I think the hand motion is what really helps it, because it's fun for people to be in a large group of people where you're all throwing your hands in the air in unison and all that kind of stuff. So.
And it was such a silly thing when it started, too. Like, he was winning matches like the worst ways possible, like by count out and stuff like that, and then celebrating like he'd won the Super Bowl.
Yes, I did it! I did it!
Do you know what's funny is that's what he had said. Celebrate like you've won the Super Bowl. And I was just like, okay.
Nice.
Yeah.
I was a fan of the wave, so I'm now a fan of yes.
That's the individual wave.
It's the individual wave.
I understand what it is.
Yeah. It's really just white people raising a roof.
I couldn't wait for the wave to come around, and it was my turn. Yay.
Do you know how many times I tried to start a wave and it failed? So humiliating.
Well, could you imagine people, like, if I was in the bathroom urinating at the airport and somebody just starts doing the wave by himself, right? Like, that would be...
And you see over the stalls, just hands.
I used to love the asshole that would try to start the wave, and he would give it a good try, too, and then he had to fucking just sit down all embarrassed.
How do you start one? I don't know how you get that many people to do anything.
You got to understand where you are in at the sporting event.
You got to get the whole section involved. Your section's got to be involved, too.
Have any of you started a wave?
Never. Hell no.
Never.
No. Yeah. Crazy? How do you do it? Never. I don't know.
You got to have balls. No, you do. You got to stand up and go, all right, we're going to do this, and you get rally.
Come on, everybody, let's do the wave.
Yeah. I try. Maybe it's where I try. Usually it wakes.
And then a sit down all humiliated. Right? Oh, God, I loved it.
Because if it goes wrong, it's the lamest shit ever.
And then they all start laughing and pointing at the guy and start
stupid
going,
asshole.
You wrote a book there, sir, called Yes.
Yeah, I wrote a book.
Nice.
It's a thing. It's a real thing now. Nice. It came out on Tuesday, and it's a real thing. And I can't. That's the weirdest part. Like I wrote this book, and I finished this book.
Yeah.
But you don't think of it as being like this real thing until it actually comes out, and like, yeah, I can physically hold it, and it's like it's there.
We just got it. I wish we could have kind of went through it a little
bit. Just got handed it.
I know. Which is kind
of
awkward.
But it does feel like a great sense of accomplishment, right? To have like a your own thing that you wrote. It's like yours.
No.
I thought I really had a good moment today. Yeah, apparently not. I just tried to start a wave.
Asshole.
He just says, wow, you don't really believe it until it's real you're holding. And I'm like, wow, so it's a chemical commentary. No, shit. Next.
Yeah. No, it's not. It's just that, like, you know, so many people have written books. And like you go to a Barnes and Noble or any bookstore, and there's literally so many thousands of books.
Yeah.
And you think of all the jerks who have written books and have published books and who had literally nothing interesting to say or nothing to contribute to humanity.
Mein Kampf comes to mind.
Think of that. And so, that was the book when he said a lot of jerks have written books. I was like, Hitler.
But and one of the things that really was really hard for me when they asked me to write this book is like, oh man, I don't want to be one of those dudes who thinks that they're so important that they should write a book, right? Like, and that's, you know, I don't want to be that kind of jerk.
But you have a story to tell. It says it right on the front cover. My improbable journey to the main event of WrestleMania.
I also want you to know that I did not come up with that subtitle for the book. So they said, what do you... they asked me, you know how when your bosses ask you a question, but it's not really a question?
Yeah.
What do you think if we title your book, Yes? Okay. We want it to be My Improbable Journey to the Main Event of WrestleMania. I mean, can't it just be Yes? Because I don't think I've said the word improbable. it is what it is. So,
where are you from?
I'm from Aberdeen, Washington.
No kidding.
Yeah.
Washington State,
yes.
That's impressive.
Yeah, and you know what? People look at me, and knowing that marijuana is legalized in Washington State, they're like, surely this man, he is dabbled. Yeah. But I've actually never smoked marijuana.
Boom!
Yes! But
no! No!
But I think that makes me an even better person to organize for the legalization of it.
Oh,
because
true.
As somebody who's been around people who have been super stoned and people who have been super drunk, I would rather be around people who have smoked a lot of marijuana.
No question.
Yeah. Right.
And so, you have no selfish interest in making it legal.
Although, Kane, who also has never smoked marijuana, he is very good at like financial stuff, and when that thing passed, he texted me, and he's like, how do we get into this marijuana trade? Like financially, like how do we get involved in this? I was like, I don't know. I think you have to be like, it's like starting a gym if you've never worked out, right? It's like, I would like to open a gym, but where do I start?
Yeah, you get a bunch of weights in your car. Place.
Are you a Nirvana fan?
So I was a slight Nirvana fan. So you have to understand that when Kurt Cobain committed suicide, I was only 14
some
or 15.
Say he was murdered, sir.
Yeah, well, he may have been.
Might want to watch Soaked in Bleach.
Soaked in Bleach, yes.
But I've become more of a fan, but I don't really like their hard stuff. Like, I'm a softer, more gentler human. I like the unplugged stuff. I think that's
I love the unplugged. Yeah.
So. He had a great voice, though.
He had an amazing voice.
Mm. Oh, good. By the way, what you all missed is Adrian.
I didn't miss it.
Good. Sam didn't miss it. Our dumb Adrian was just ducking, and he cracked his head on the corner of the TV.
Oh, I saw it. Yeah, I saw it.
How nice was that?
Yeah. Oh,
I hope you're really smart. What did you do before you wrestled?
I mean, I've been wrestling since I was 18 years old, so I was in high school.
So how is this improbable?
Yeah, what's exactly.
It seemed like you were on a very good track to get to WrestleMania.
You should say my collision course with wrestling.
I think you have to kind of understand...
my inevitable journey to WrestleMania is not as good a title.
I think you just have to understand the wrestling business a little bit to understand that like a 5'8", 185-pound person who really, when I was young and even now, who has very few social skills and is bad at like public speaking. Like one of the things I talk about in the book is there was an incident, and this wasn't the only incident. It was multiple times where like, hey, read your book report in front of the class, in front of 25 people. I literally could not do it.
Yeah.
Like I tried and tried and could not. I couldn't finish it. I couldn't get past three paragraphs. So you tell somebody standing in that class, and that was my senior year of high school, like literally 2 or 3 months later, I'm going off to be a wrestler. You tell that person, like, no, he's going to go out there and stand up in front of thousands of people in his little spandex battle jammies, and he's going to address these people in a confident manner. You're just going to be like,
that's improbable.
So, so how'd you get over that?
Yeah.
But I want to add this, I think sometimes it's easier to talk to a lot more people than 20 people.
But he's also in fucking underwear doing it.
Good point.
And that's why it's taken me so long, is because like I didn't have these skills. Like The Rock, for example.
Yeah.
The Rock, when he when he first came into WWE, they were instantly like, this guy's going to be a star. Look at him. And he wasn't a star at first. Like, he had to kind of learn
more. He was kind of goofy. I'm afraid to say he was goofy at first.
He was a little goofy at first. But he had those qualities, those traits that you see and be like, this guy is going to be a star.
Right.
Right? Like, people say that you can't learn that. I feel like you can. And, like, just because, like, hey, if you do enough stuff that puts you out of your comfort zone, like, 6 years ago, you guys have me on this show, I'd just be sweating bullets. Like, right. I'd just be like, oh, I have to go out and talk, and, like, a bunch of people are going to be listening to this thing, and, like, what if I say something really stupid, right? Like,
and you'll fit right in.
Yeah.
Never stop me.
But at least if you're going to say something stupid, you say it confidently. Like, right. Like that guy who starts the wave, and he's just like,
He sells it.
He sells it. So, like, it's, that's why I think it's improbable. And, like, if you were to read the book, you would see that, like, nobody really ever wanted me to be in that spot. So it's...
Mm. Plus, you're like 5'8". Who else was 5'8" and the champion of the world?
I mean, there have been a couple guys, but not very many. So,
and recently? In recent history?
Rey Mysterio was only 5'3", but he was not the... It was a different time. It's hard to explain all this stuff. But
I don't think Bruno Sammartino was that tall.
He was taller than 5'8".
Was he taller than 5'8"?
He's taller than me now, even when he's, like, older, and you know how people shrink a little bit?
Yeah.
But he's, also bigger than me now. Like he's still, like, I think he still benches, like, 350 pounds. Like, you just look at him.
He's going to be 80 this year.
Yeah. What?
And he's still bench pressing?
But, Daniel, so, I mean, but you had to get in front of that audience. Like, how did you do that? Like, what? So, how do you get through that first one where you're like, holy fuck, I didn't want to get up in my classroom and now I'm in front of a bunch of people.
Right, yeah, it was tough. And it's one of the things that helped is I was trained by Shawn Michaels, and so he put me in a mask because I was very expressionless when I first started. Like, I like probably terrified. He said expressionless, but I think the look would probably be more like terrified. And so they put a mask on me, and that actually helped. It helped me feel like I wasn't myself. Like,
I used that during sex.
Yeah.
Along with other burglary tools.
A glass cutter.
Yeah. Why would you do that to yourself?
So it helped you get out of yourself because you're like, hey, no one can see it's me, and you feel like a character.
Yeah, it's
freeing.
And you know, when you say that, it's not like I came out and I was super bombastic and like all this. Like,
right.
But, you know, I literally walked out to the ring my first match with this mask on and these tights, and I was just like,
it was a don't look at me mask.
Yeah, okay. But once I started wrestling, that's the thing, is that I have always loved wrestling. That's what that's how I've gotten to kind of where I've been, is just this passion that I have for actually doing it, being in there and doing the wrestling part. It's just so much fun. And once I got in there and was doing that, I lost the fact that there were, my first match was in front of like 200 people. I lost the fact that there were 200 people in there.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, and then you just progress and then you get more comfortable and more comfortable.
Is it hard to watch your old stuff? Like, for a stand-up comedian, it's hard to watch our old material and see you do spot. It's like, awful.
I honestly can't watch my new material. So when I watch myself, all I see are the faults. Right. And it's this constant self-critique as far as, like, and this is one of the things that some guys are very proud of their matches and that sort of thing. I love when I'm out there. When I come back, I feel so good.
Right.
But then when I watch myself, and it's not that I'm critical or harsh or anything like that, but this is not good. This needs to be better. And that is part of the evolution of how I've gotten to be one of the better guys in wrestling, is this nothing is ever good enough. Right. It's never like, I'm trying to reach for this point of artistic perfection, and you never get there.
Never.
It's constantly moving. Yeah. And there's an understanding in that. It's like, you're never, your martial arts is never, you're never done training in martial arts. Like, I don't know if you guys have read George St. Pierre's book. It's fascinating on how he looks at martial arts and that sort of thing. And it was, this constant progression. He was the best guy in the world.
Right.
And this constantly, I have to keep learning new stuff. Because once you open this door to knowledge, you realize how much you don't know. You know, like,
endless. It's an endless amount.
You can never know everything.
And, do you take martial arts too, or is it just wrestling?
Yeah, no, I like, so for example, I like a lot of jiu-jitsu stuff, catch wrestling stuff, kickboxing stuff. Like, I, I, I'm into that sort of thing. I like I like grappling, so like submission type grappling, because it makes me feel like I feel like that's how humans are supposed to play, right?
Yeah.
Like when you watch dogs play, right? What they're doing is they're actually fighting without hurting each other. Yeah. I would never want to be in UFC.
But they also sniff each other's assholes.
Right.
Yeah.
Somebody else will enjoy
it. Yeah, yeah. Good point. I mean, when you get down to it, if you haven't been there, you know, like so you know, but it's just one of those things. One of the things that I think that we've really lost as a humanity is these things that humans just naturally enjoy, as far as like, hey, I don't want to hurt you, but come on, you know, let's like that's it, and
let's start grappling, guys.
Yeah,
what do you say?
So yeah, that's one of the things that I truly enjoy. And then when you do it more and more, then obviously you want to get better at it, and then there's an artistry to it. So
yeah, CM Punk is gonna fight. He's saying maybe by December or January if he's ready, but he's never fought. He's a tough guy, but that's a very tough thing to break
that's
into.
That's a fascinating story. We'll see how that plays out, because he can't get a soft opponent either.
No,
They need to pick that perfect guy where people are like, oh, wow, he's going to fall. Okay, you know, let's see what he can do.
But you also can't put him in with a top 15
guy. No kidding, that's what I'm saying.
It's just not fair.
He's got to be handpick a guy where he still has respect.
Even if he loses, he just has to fight well. Even if he loses, he has to look like it was a good fight, because, you know, you're going to lose, but it doesn't have to be, you just don't want to get killed in the first 10 seconds.
Yeah, I mean, even then, I don't even think that's the point. I think it's gutsy of him to go in there and do it.
Yeah,
right?
So, like, if he's, I don't know how old he is. He might be like 35-ish.
Wow.
But to get in there, and I go in and, you know, and I trained at Extreme Couture in Las Vegas, which is Randy Couture's gym, and I've trained at the MMA lab in Phoenix, which is where Benson Henderson trains, and John Crouch is the coach there and stuff. And those guys who are like, those guys now aren't guys who are just starting to train MMA at 25, 26, 27. These people have trained MMA since they were teenagers, right? Or they're, you know, that sort of thing. So now you're dealing with kids who are 23 years old, who are exceptional athletes, who have been training in this for 7 years. You know what I mean? So the entry level position for UFC is a lot higher than it was even 6 years ago.
Agreed.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's just tough, but it's very courageous. It's a courageous thing to do. It's saying, I want to go do something, and I'm going to do it, and all these people are telling me that I can't. Screw you.
Good for him.
Yeah, good for him.
Oh, yeah, we're fans of his. We wish him nothing but the best for that.
Did you ever talk to Brock about his time in UFC or no?
No, I have probably said 7 words to Brock in my entire life, and it's usually this. Hello, sir, how are you? Good. Me too.
That's a big son of a bitch.
Yeah.
Why isn't he more friendly?
I just think he's quiet. Like, he's just a quiet dude, keeps to himself.
You see him a lot. You should be, I don't know.
We don't see him that much.
Oh, well, that's true. Yeah, you see him six times a year or something, maybe.
No, you're right. You're right. Yeah, back in the day, you saw him more before he left for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
How's the neck?
It's great. I feel great.
You're coming back from a neck injury, or
no? So I had neck surgery in May of last year.
Okay,
and then I came back in January of this year, and then now I'm off hurt again. But this is more of a concussion issue.
Oh, okay.
So
now, are you surprised by all the success from the Diva show on E? Because that show is huge.
I mean,
me and my girlfriend are addicted to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I honestly,
I know you're trying to have a baby. I know all the secrets about you. I shouldn't know.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. And so they just did this thing where we went to a fertility clinic and I had to deposit my semen.
And a sound dude and the camera guy in the hallway waiting for you.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's the weirdest jerk.
I didn't know that they were honestly not supposed. That wasn't why they were there. They were there shooting like B-roll stuff. So it's like, so while he's in there, you know, this is, you know, the thing. And then I just so happened to come out.
And I see you like this. What the fuck are y'all doing in the hallway?
Yeah.
You got a cup of jizz.
Yeah. It's exposing a little more of my life than I would have thought.
You know?
So. Sipping it on the way out.
There's the cameraman.
Yeah. So.
Well, how'd it go?
I mean, I'm super fertile.
Okay.
I mean, cool. I don't know if you can just look at me and see how super fertile
I am. The first thing I thought, that's a great name for a superhero,
wow,
by the way.
Yeah, this
super
guy.
It's super fertile.
Yeah. This guy has got to be fertile. Look at his facial hair. So
one of the good things about the book, though, and I think when you're talking about the journey being improbable, is you guys probably don't know, but the reason that he went to WrestleMania, like, they had a plan for WrestleMania, and it was a whole thing. And fans reacted so poorly to what they saw was WWE's plan.
The plan, right.
Uh-huh. And reacted so differently to Brian the WWE had to change the entire.
They had to change
plan.
It. I told you that. You saying right. like I didn't yeah. tell him that.
Jim was telling me before the show.
Yeah, the fans changed all that.
They had to change the whole thing and send him to the main event and have him win the title. And
so
everything.
The fans fucking was like, no, we want Daniel.
Yeah, they were like, we reject your idea for WrestleMania. Yeah.
We do.
What
not...
was the original idea again? I do know a little bit.
It
about
was
this.
It was going to be Batista against Randy Orton in the main event. Yes. And then it was going to be Triple H versus CM Punk. And then what had happened is Batista didn't get the reactions that they wanted. Wanted he instead of being the getting the hero's welcome that they had anticipated and wanted him to get people
fans started calling him Bautista
and then CM Punk quit and then all of a sudden now there's two big spots at WrestleMania that they need somebody to fill these spots and like they literally could not have had Bautista and Randy Orton go on last at WrestleMania people would have left.
Yeah. Would that not have been a big moment if they had gone on last?
It would have been interesting to see what would have happened. Yeah. You know, like, but I'm thankful they didn't chance that.
Well, me and Jimmy certainly would have left.
Yeah. We've only been to one. We left early. It was cold.
They went to WrestleMania 29 and couldn't understand why they were the only ones leaving before The Rock and John Cena.
Before The Rock and John Cena match. Yeah,
The Rock and John Cena. Oh, I guess so.
I guess it was. You would know. You didn't stay.
It was cold too. It was out.
It was cold, bastard. It was cold. I was tired.
I was tired.
It was Giant Stadium, and you know, rumor was it was going to be at least 2 hours in the parking lot to just leave.
Yeah.
To start your journey back to Manhattan. So me and Jimmy looked at each other like, "You've seen enough. Yeah, I've seen enough." Yeah,
that was Opie and Jim's improbable journey to WrestleMania.
Yes, it was an enjoyable, well done event. I felt like I was very impressed with it.
And then we're the only car leaving the parking lot, except for the only other car moving was a security car going from mile to mile. I mean, we had a wide
did they stop
room.
You? Did they stop you guys? Unreal. Like wondering, these guys are up to something. Right. Surely
the venue is there, idiots. Yeah.
And we're here in the.
Yeah.
Well, we were happy just to get home at a nice.
You're old women.
No, I mean the other part of it too. You do morning radio. That clock really starts ticking.
Plus,
especially if you're a little older doing mornings.
You'd seen your Fandango match, so you were happy.
We were big fans of Fandango.
Yeah. Oh yeah. I'm a big fan of Fandango.
Is he
yeah.
still doing it? I don't even
yeah,
know.
Absolutely. Yeah. He doesn't get as much.
It's not fair what they've done.
Yeah.
But I thought they made him wrestle too soon. I really did. That whole fucking work where he just wouldn't wrestle because it just didn't feel right was
because
hilarious.
Because they didn't say his name properly.
Right. I thought it was hilarious, and they should have just really just let that go for a while longer. But he had so much heat, then they threw him in that WrestleMania.
What'd they do that's not good?
With Fandango?
Yeah, you said they did something that's not good.
Well, just once he started wrestling, it was like all that sort of like... thing, all the Fandango stuff, they just kind of stopped it, and they just had him kind of wrestling in matches that
they went
like,
too early with it. I'm telling you, they should have done.
Well, they didn't really do anything with him after he started wrestling.
I know because
that
was
a grand idea, and then that was that.
Oh, okay,
yeah.
So, what is he? Just kind of a low level guy now?
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah.
That was hilarious.
If you see him at all. Like, which is too bad because he's a very talented, very entertaining person.
So he has to come back and reinvent himself as a new character, probably.
We'll have to see. I don't know. Those aren't my decisions.
It's Triple H?
Yeah. What's that?
Who decides that?
I don't know. Not me.
I like that. He's just keeping his head low, man.
Keep my head down. Let the fans do my work for me. Yeah. Like they're the ones who are just like
you and Triple H went at it once, huh? We had a nice screaming match backstage.
We almost got in the fight.
What was it? It was a match, and then Triple H decided he had to stop it because of medical reasons.
Yeah. So what had happened was I had gotten a stinger in a match and lost feeling in my in both arms.
That's some scary shit.
The left one came back pretty quick. The right one was still just kind of flopping by my side. I have a mentality of never stopping a match for any reason. And whether that's good or bad, it's you know, that was my mentality.
And a stinger is what, like a really hard hit that's harder than it's supposed to be?
No, it's so something happens with your neck and you lose kind of feeling and that sort of thing.
It's temporary paralysis.
Oh. Yeah.
You got the old Cosby.
Yeah.
But you guys understand the stingers to some point where you're like, oh, all right, this is a stinger. I know the feeling will come back.
You don't really know, though.
Yeah, I mean, it was
just faith, right?
Just good faith.
It could be
one where it went too far and now, oh, fuck, I'm paralyzed.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right.
It's literally, it was my first one. I'd never had a stinger before.
Scary.
And so there I am with my arm dangling and trying to finish this match, and the Triple H tells the medical doctor that, who's at ringside, because he's asking me if I'm okay, and I'm like, yeah, I'm fine, leave me alone. And he's like, so then they tried to stop the match, and then I sprinted into the ring after they tried to stop the match and try to keep the match going, and I'm with Randy Orton, I'm wrestling Randy Orton, and try to, because this was going to be like probably the biggest win of my career up to that point.
Did you tell him that you had one? Like, did he know that you were a little...
No. What happened was I did a dive out of the ring. My head hit the barricade, and then that's where...
Are you fucking kidding me? Well,
and so that happened, but I felt fine. I felt the little thing in my arm. But then I went to the top rope and did a top rope drop kick. And the top rope drop kick is actually harder on me than it is on my opponent. What happens is I do it and I kick him, but then from that elevation, I just land on my back. And when I landed on my back, I couldn't get up, and I was just like there, and I couldn't.
Now, that's scary shit.
I couldn't move my arms, and Randy, who was like, he's on the ground going, Dan, what's going on, Dan? And Dan, he was cussing, but he was like, what the f are you doing? You know what I mean? And like, and I just lay in there, and
like,
the referee,
like, you were just doing it for fun.
Yeah. And the referee was,
I'm planking. This is my new move. Yeah, relax.
And the referee came over and goes, are you okay? I said, I can't move. And like, but then I could move. And then so like, you know, and so anyways, Triple H stopped the match. He had the doctor stop the match, and they stopped me from finishing. And you have to understand, I've finished the match after detaching my retina. I wrestled 55. I did an hour-long match where 5 minutes in, I separated my shoulder, and my shoulder was just, you know, there. And so, and I finished the rest of my match. And keep in mind that this was not in front of thousands of people. This was in front of hundreds of people. So, like, I have had this mentality of, like, you don't stop my matches. Yeah. And when I came back, I was hot. And typically, I'm very relaxed and that sort of thing. But, yeah, we got, when I say nose to nose, I don't think that's completely accurate because he's like 6'3". So like, yeah. But whatever it
nose
was.
Nose to
it
belly
was,
button.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. And so we came pretty close.
What was his reasoning? Like, you were fucked up. I had to do it.
Yeah, no. It's kind of an older mentality, and it's the same thing with football and other sports now, is that, you know, you keep playing through the pain, but right. Now they're more conscious of looking out for the competitors.
And yeah, with concussions and everything.
Yeah, with all of that stuff. Yeah. They're more conscious of protecting us from ourselves, because most athletes, if you let them...
Oh, they'll do it. They'll play.
Yeah, they'll go, and, you know, and so...
You were temporarily paralyzed, and you got mad that they stopped it.
Yeah, and I was mad. And so, and one of the things that... So I talk about it in the book, but one of the things that I also acknowledge that I was in the wrong. Oh. That doesn't make you... Just being wrong doesn't make you any less angry, right?
Yeah,
you
know,
like,
that's true.
Like, how many people are wrong unjustifiably?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that was me in that moment. And it's like, and Bree said to me, she's like, but you know he was right to stop that, right? You know, like, you know that he did what was the correct thing.
Yes. So it's,
yeah, but screw him. Like, you know, that was my moment. So, yeah.
Well, wow. How'd you detach your retina?
I talk about that in the book too, and it's actually that I was wrestling a 350-pound Japanese man who he would come in and he would wrestle. I was on the independents, and most of the independent wrestlers were smaller. When he was in Japan, he would beat the crap out of guys. Like, just, it was awesome, right? Like, you know, just like this monster, you know? But he'd get in with us, and he was such a nice man that when he would wrestle smaller guys, he felt like he couldn't do anything mean to him, right? But that's not what fans want to see. You're a 350-pound monster. If you're wrestling a guy who's under 200 pounds, we want to see you destroy him, right? We don't want to see just, you know, you gingerly, you know, doing all that kind of stuff. So the promoter had told me, or the booker had said, hey, we need you to get something out of this guy. So I just low-kicked him to death. Like, I don't know if you guys know much about leg kicks and like an MMA and Muay Thai and stuff like that, but they suck. And like, so I told him beforehand, I said, like, hey, I need you to be intense out there. Don't be afraid that I'm only 185 pounds. I need you to treat me like you would treat a heavyweight in Japan. And he's like, oh, okay. You know what I mean? And then like, at first he was just being real ginger and it, but I kept kicking the crap out of his leg until the point where he could barely walk afterwards, but he got that anger in him that he wanted to beat the crap out of me. And then I took it too far. And he started giving me these clubbing blows to the face, and then fractured my orbital bone and detached my retina.
And he's like that? That's how you want it?
No, and then he's such a nice man that afterwards, even though he's like limping and has these huge welts all over his legs, he's like, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. And like, they didn't know at that point that I had detached my retina. All was happening was that my eye was going into the back of my head, and the doctor was like, yeah.
What are you fucking talking about?
We got to get you out of here.
Oh, my God.
Panicking. Your guy is panicking.
The book is called Yes.
Yes.
My
improbable journey to the main event of WrestleMania. Yeah, I've learned it by now. I've forgotten it many times.
And we got book signings for Daniel Bryan. You got to come back.
Yeah.
We like you, Daniel.
I want a book.
Tonight, Barnes & Noble in Stamford, Connecticut at 7. Saturday, Barnes & Noble in Phoenix. July 29th, Barnes & Noble in Seattle. It goes on and on. So
on and on and on.
Nice. WWE Daniel Bryan on Twitter. And how do they get the book signings as far as where you're going to be?
Has there been tweeting them?
Is there one
so
place to go? WWE's website?
Yeah, okay. WWE's Superstar Appearances page on their website.
Okay, they'll figure it out.
Yeah, I'll tweet about it. I'm going to try to. I'm very bad at social media, but I'm going to start trying to be better.
We're kind of... I'm stupid. I mean, the fans are going to show up, obviously.
Yeah.
You're going to have no problem with that.
We had a sellout last night in New Jersey for it, and then we did one in New York City last night. At Bookends in New Jersey that was sold out. People were amazing. We did one during the middle of the day yesterday in New York City that had well over 350 people there. I think this guy presented me with a Lego portrait of Brie, right? he's a very skilled Lego man, and he like created this portrait of Brie that looks just like her.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah, and so like,
did you tweet that?
I Instagrammed it.
All right, okay. We have to take a look at that.
Yeah.
It was a good Sam.
Yeah, it was. It looked like her.
Yeah, it was. Yeah, it was exactly her. So
there was shading and everything. I don't know. There was like flesh shading. I didn't know there were that many different.
With Lego?
Lego flesh color.
I'll show you how to do that.
Thank you, holy fuck! You ain't kidding.
Yeah.
Damn.
Are you looking at it? Yeah.
I was like, it really looks like that. Wow.
Yeah. What an incredible talent that man has, right?
Yes.
How the fuck that he shaded out in the face and the hair? And
I'll
like,
explain it.
Yeah, I'll explain.
I've done Lego shading.
Also, like, the Brian's here, like, pitching his book about his amazing, like, whatever it is, 15-year wrestling career. And he's like, look at what an amazing, talented Lego man. Look at the talent
on this
guy.
But you know what? When he came up to me, he kind of said that, like, you're very talented at what you do. Like, I hope you appreciate this. This is what I'm passionate about, and this is my skill set. And it makes you realize that out of all these billions of people that are on this planet, like, everybody has unique talents and is very special, and, like... It's awesome.
Yours is good for survival, though.
Yeah.
That's, Lego is nice, but that's not a caveman thing.
But in prison, that can get you. Be like, here's your girlfriend. Yeah. Everybody protect you in prison.
Exactly. Yeah. Here's your girlfriend. It's a guy named Leon with a blonde wig. There you go.
All right, Daniel. We got to get you out of here. Thank you so much.
I want to get a pic.
We'll do a little picture action and blah, blah, blah. We'll be back. Stay there. Back with Kurt Metzger. And Sherrod Small, the stars of Race Wars. They had a great one last night on this channel.
Thank you, sir.
Daniel Bryan was great.
He's a real nice guy.
And Sam was telling us stories after Daniel Bryan left.
Yeah.
Some hilarious stories. I wish I knew a couple of these before the interview.
Yeah, Sam.
That would have been very helpful if we had a couple of those in our back pockets.
Why don't you tell us?
Yeah, that's right. I mean, the reason his journey to WrestleMania was so improbable was because Vince McMahon wanted him anywhere except the main event.
Yes, I can see that Vince
is not a fan of his or wasn't a fan of his at the time?
I'm sure he's warmed up to him at this point, but it was like he had to get... so organically popular with the audience for them to even acknowledge.
Then that's the improbable part.
Right, like they didn't even want to make him a t-shirt at first.
Why did the fans was attracted to him so much?
He's fucking awesome.
He is awesome. I love him.
Because he's got that personality.
Well, he's
very likable.
But he's like one of the few guys who you can... Like most of the time you get entertained by either the promos or the entrances or whatever it is. Like his matches entertain people.
Right.
Like he's that good at wrestling.
It's his wrestling style and the skills that he's playing.
Jim and I enjoy it together.
Can you tell the jacket story?
Yeah. One of the stories in the book is like he has this jacket made by this like comic book artist, and it's like a military style jacket, and I think it said DB, Daniel Bryan, on the back, and it almost looked like an anarchy symbol, and he wanted to kind of have this like revolutionary feel to him because the fans were uprising and all this stuff. And he didn't tell anybody about the jacket. He just had it made, and then he put it on right before he went out. And so, like, I was thinking, you know, when you go out to the ring, it's like performing anything. Like, you have to have a certain confidence. You have to be like, okay, I'm ready to perform in front of an audience.
Right.
So, like, he gets to the ring, and I don't know how he could perform following. Like, he gets to the ring. He's doing the yes thing. He's got his hands in the air. And the referee leans into him, and he goes, take the jacket off. And he's, like, trying to, like, get the fans behind him. He goes, what? And the referee goes, take the jacket off now. And then he realizes that the referee has an earpiece in, and Vince McMahon is screaming.
Psychopath.
In the backstage going, what the fuck is he wearing? Tell him to get the jacket off. Take the jacket off now.
Wow, he hates him.
And
why does he have a problem with a jacket, though? Does Vince McMahon manage everything you wear?
Everything. I mean, yeah. Like a Vince McMahon.
You can't shit on
his name's
Vince
not Daniel
you.
Bryan.
Right.
His name's Brian Danielson, but yeah. They made him change his name to Daniel Bryan.
Sounds too Karate Kid. Yeah. That's why it's too Brian Danielson. Sounds too Karate Kid. That's why.
They told him he had to change
Wait,
his name.
So what's his real name?
Brian Danielson.
Brian Danielson, now he's Daniel Bryan.
Because they want to own the name.
Everything's a lie, wrestling.
It's all a lie.
That's
a lie.
I did not know that.
Own the name. It's so smart.
Yeah, wow.
Because that way, when he leaves WWE, he can't be Daniel Bryan anymore.
Robert Sam will be wrestling tomorrow. Yeah. I like that.
Robbie
Samuels.
He can't
leave with his name?
They can't leave with their names.
No. He's got to go back to being Bryan after
that.
But
what about The Rock? The Rock still says The Rock?
But that's because Vince McMahon was the executive producer on his first, like, three or four movies.
Oh.
Was he?
Yeah. He's the Lorne Michaels of fucking wrestling.
Yeah, he is.
Who are some of the wrestlers that couldn't leave with their names, and then what were their names when they had to change them?
Oh, right? That's a good question.
China had to change hers. Remember,
she became China Doll.
Yeah, she became Big Clint McGillicuddy.
And she legally changed it.
Yeah, and Bubba Ray.
Bubba Ray Dudley became Bully Ray.
Bully Ray.
No last name.
He couldn't take his name with all the heat he built up for himself.
This group, TNA, did an ECW like reunion pay-per-view, except after ECW went out of business, Vince McMahon bought the intellectual property library, so he owns every name. So they literally had to change the name of every wrestler on the show. So, like, there was a wrestler named Balls Mahoney. That was his name.
Yeah, what did his name become?
He just came out to the name Cajones.
Holy shit. That's awesome.
That can't be a real story.
Wait, what did Taz have to have it change his name?
Taz has gone back and forth between Taz with one Z and Taz with two Zs.
Oh, that's so how he got around it?
Yeah, so he put two Zs on it.
Oh, Raz or Taz?
All right. Rhino has to spell his name either
with R-I-C.
Douglas Shane?
He's right. He has to do it either with an I or a Y.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
But it's smart for Vince McMahon.
Yeah, like, he won't let anybody come in anymore. Like, you know, John Cena, that's his name. Like, that generation of guys got to use their real names, but after him...
There's nothing he can do. He'll own his name
And these
forever.
Poor guys...
No more.
The mean blue guy!
What if you legally change your name to your wrestling name?
That's what China did, I guess.
That's what China did.
The Ultimate Warrior did that. He legally changed his name to Warrior.
To Ultimate.
And then he can't fuck with it. Yeah. And Vince is...
First name Ultimate.
Vince is a billionaire, and he's fucking with these guys.
That's why he's a billionaire.
These poor guys, their time with the WWE is up, and they can't move on with their name to get maybe
shameful.
A little extra heat.
That's like what Brian said, though. He was like...
That's too much.
He said that even though he's, like, the best wrestler, he has to keep being a better wrestler and a better wrestler. Vince McMahon has to keep being a better billionaire, so he just has to keep owning more people.
So he owns all those wrestling names.
Oh, yeah.
You didn't know that one?
No.
Yeah, it's so sad when they leave and have to change their name.
Yeah, they can't.
He's like, I'm just Roy now.
Not only are they performing to a much lesser crowd and TV exposure, and then they have to have some shitty name that is almost like their name when they were a superstar.
Dude, Cajones is pretty bad. Why don't you be Cajones now?
Like, I know, like, indie promoters that are promoting these, like, shows in front of, like, 300 people in a gym or whatever, and they put flyers up all over town, except they're on the East Coast, and so is WWE. So I've talked to them. They're like, yeah, we had to take all our flyers down. I was like, why? And they're like, because we got a cease and desist from WWE because of the photos and the names.
Oh, man.
Because it's all WWE guys on the flyers.
Why not be like Balls Mooney or something? Like, no, why go to Cajone?
Wait a minute. So they can't even put their images up there?
If it's a WWE image. Promo image,
right.
That's their image. Like, they could take a new photo.
Does WWE utilize their lawyers?
From time to time, they'll pull them out of the bowl. Pen.
Didn't Hollywood Hogan have that was because of Marvel, right? Not Vince McMahon, or was that
Vince McMahon? I think for a while,
but everyone accepted that.
Marvel like, owned that the name Hulk, but now they've reached some kind of deal on
like that. That was his alter ego, so it kind of worked with him.
Yeah. It was Hollywood,
yeah.
Wait, Marvel owned Hulk,
yeah,
yeah. But now there's something there. Yeah, they had to reach some kind of deal. But yeah.
Too that funny.
Because he just changed his name, right? No one calls him Terry anyway.
No, nobody calls him Terry. People call him Hulkster in his personal life.
I call him that.
What's
that
going on, Hulkster?
That ex-wife called him Terry.
Yeah, exactly.
That's why that bitch had to go. That bitch had to go.
Terry. No, brother, call me Hulkster. Only she calls me Terry.
Whatever happened to her?
She just started banging Linda? That 19-year-old dude, and they broke up.
They broke up.
They all went on to people that look like their family members.
Yes, they did.
She found a version of the boy to fuck. He found his daughter.
Very creepy.
Brooke is sexy, though, man.
Yeah, she is.
She is.
She's super sexy, man.
Yeah. She's a good singer, too.
She's a big girl.
Got a lot of talents.
I love her sex appeal. She's a big girl. Huggable.
She's a big girl. Oh, yeah. Strong.
I like, remember when his kid fucked up that guy? Like, he got in the car accident. And the recording of Hogan, like, boy, he must have had some karma coming in his life.
Oh, that was bad.
Hogan put it on the guy.
Like, oh, yes.
Not his fuck up kid.
That was like, his kid crashed the car. Yes. But he was like, yeah, the passenger must really did some evil things.
I mean, I can't explain it other than
it's like karma, brother.
Brutal.
Is that kid okay or no?
I don't know.
No, not at all.
Up, no, he will never be the same again.
Yeah, I missed that show though.
And he can't even keep his real name after the accident.
Remember, he was a barbie. He was like having a cookout, and he had like Jewish people at his house, Hong Kong, and he was like this: "These are the kosher burgers. These are the regular burgers on the same grill." You don't know how this works, do you? Fucking idiot.
Well, our favorite scene from that is when he visited his mansion, and he wasn't allowed to step on shore. And his little dog came up to the edge of the property and was barking, and they're all crying.
Why couldn't he?
Because it was after the divorce. Time. He was looking at his house from a boat.
He was looking at his house that, you know, from his money from being a huge star in
they
wrestling.
Let me keep the boat, brother, but I can't go to my house.
And it was Hulk Hogan and Brooke, and they decided to go check out the house from the water, and they got really close, but they weren't allowed. And it's basically saying, if we go any further, we could get sued, and the dogs are coming up trying to say hi and jump on the boat. And they're just bawling.
It's so sad. And she's fucking that 19-year-old boy then?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, so he's in your house and you can't come to your house?
You can't come to your own house.
Oh, you should have to sell it and split the money. You should should never be able to fuck a younger guy in the house when she did nothing to earn the money.
When you know that was your career that built that house.
She supported him.
And you guys
she raised the kids.
You all condemned OJ for fighting for what's his.
Hey, can you explain Rainbow Stew? I know you were telling us
X-Pac,
during the break.
X-Pac came on Race Wars, and he said when he was the 1-2-3 kid at the time.
Right.
So all those big, like Kevin Nash, was it Kevin Nash he said? Like,
yeah, they would send him out.
They go, kid, go get the Rainbow Stew. And he would go and collect drugs from the fans.
Yeah, all kinds of drugs. It's all different colors. They put it in one hand, and then they smash them all.
All at once.
All at once. Rainbow Stew.
They would do it like that?
Yeah. They would just eat whatever anybody had.
They eat whatever. He's like, he didn't even know what drugs were most of them. He didn't even know what it was, but it was all a handful each. They all had a handful of fucking random in a bag. And it's
wow. And now they call the Rainbow Stew.
Those dudes are, I mean, not X-Pac is reasonable size, but those guys are huge. We could probably just take all kinds of shit.
He wasn't that big.
X-Pac
he's
the guys,
solid, though.
The guys he was hanging out with were giant. Oh, yeah. You
ever see Andre the Giant?
Contribution.
I remember I saw Sergeant Slaughter one time.
Yeah, I saw him in the Carnegie Deli.
Did you?
Yeah.
I saw him at the Garden, like outside. I saw the Junkyard Dog at Shea Stadium.
Really?
With his family.
Just having a dog?
I was like, motherfucker, you got a family? With kids and shit, cross the street, little girl. I'm like, that's a Junkyard Dog!
Whatever happened? Is he gone?
He died in a car accident, I think.
Right, that's right.
Oh, no, did he really?
I think he did, yeah.
He was sitting on one that got picked up and crushed. He's a junkyard.
I think he fell asleep or something driving, right?
Oh, no.
I'm trying to remember.
Junkyard dog. The apparent cause he ate some chocolate and died.
The apparent cause was falling asleep at the wheel. There you go. Yeah, no. His body
really?
Was...
Wow.
What did he hit?
Unmarked grave.
What?
Maybe he didn't want his fans wolfing at his grave.
Peeing on it.
With left and a leg.
I got chopped.
Marked his grave. Whatever.
I got chopped in the chest by Virgil at the Iron Sheep roast because I said,
"Oh yeah,
Virgil." I said that Jesse Joyce used to Virgil for Greg Giraldo. Virgil came over and chopped me in the chest.
It
didn't hurt though. It was just very loud. It was like he did like a full on wrestling.
Oh really?
Wow. Was he trying to hurt you? Cool.
No.
No, he probably would have hurt me if he was trying to hurt me.
What happened with you and Virgil on your show?
He's a psycho, dude. He was on
my
show.
I watched that interview.
I heard.
What happened? A lot of it. Yeah, I didn't get to the end of it because I was doing something. Falling asleep.
We came.
No, it was good. It was Sam handled him pretty well.
You got some heat for that, though. What happened?
Well, he came in bragging about his 14.5-inch penis.
Well, that
immediately,
sounds like
right off the top, he started trying to get Nicole, who was in there, to blow him.
How did he say it?
Well, first he sat on her lap instead of sitting down in a chair immediately after getting there. Then he wheeled his chair so he was like knees to knees with her and grabbed her chair by her arms.
Right.
So like she was stuck in his space.
Yeah.
Rapey.
It's my blowjob space.
Right. And then I was saying, you know, because he was saying he's got a 14.5-inch penis, and then he said he would suck his own dick for $15,000. And I was like, well, why don't you just do it? Why don't you just do it? And then he grabbed Nicole and tried to get her to do it.
Well, I mean, tried to get her to do it.
Like, yeah. He was like, you do it. And he like was grabbing her shoulder.
Oh, my God.
I was like, Virgil, we're not going to sexually harass people in the studio.
Nicole?
Yeah.
Oh, Virgil.
Mash up Nicole.
That ain't right.
No. And then,
I think he has a point, Virgil.
Absolutely.
He came after me.
Shuck his dick. He knows what he wants.
Halfway through the interview, he pulled out a pair of scissors that I didn't know he had. I legit didn't know yet.
Who gave Virgil scissors?
Apparently the fucking security at the front desk at this crack establishment, SiriusXM.
They didn't check him for scissors?
They didn't. No, they gave him the scissors.
Oh, okay.
What was he going to do with them?
He started walking towards me with the scissors because I started bringing up the lonely Virgil was my creation.
Was he not happy with that?
No, he wasn't psyched about it. He said he was gonna break his foot off in my ass.
Was he nice to you, though? I mean, I think he was okay with it.
Yeah, I mean, he's kind of nuts.
Why was he going to break his foot off in your ass?
Because I created a website that's just photos of him sitting at autograph signing.
Oh, yeah. I didn't realize that.
It's hilarious.
It's hilarious.
It's called lonelyvirgil.net.
Oh, that's how... When I
it's photos of Virgil with no fanfare.
The best is where he sets up in the parking lot and stuff, because he's not allowed in the actual venue.
Yeah.
Do you have that one?
I'm sure. I mean, at one point, I asked him about setting up an autograph signing outside somebody else's autograph signing in a yellow sweatsuit, which he denied, so I had to show him the photo and ask him, Virgil, what color sweatsuit are you wearing? And he admitted he was wearing a yellow sweatsuit.
So wait a minute, that was someone else's signing inside?
Yeah. Somebody was in the store signing, and he set up his table so that he could harass people online.
He's the Rich Voss of this.
I know.
He set up a table outside, Virgil waiting for the masses to arrive outside of a store called George's Collectibles.
Did anyone go to his signing?
Well, he does what they do.
He looks like a banana.
A lonely
sad
banana
waiting for.
Is the parking lot one a Photoshop?
No, not one. Every photo on that website is legit.
Lonely photo.
That one, he's in the street.
LonelyVirgil.net is a website with integrity.
Do you see this picture? We're going to have it on the big screen.
Even like Lucy from Charlie Brown, I'll be giving advice.
Yeah, he does it but his method is like the guys in Times Square, like tricking tourists into buying CDs.
Right.
Like he shows up and he goes he sees a guy with like an old school wrestling shirt on. I've seen him do it 100 times. He goes, old school, baby, old school, old school, baby, old school. Come here, old school, old school. And so somebody walks over to him and he's got like a table full of photos. And he goes, who's your favorite? Which one's your favorite photo? Which one's your favorite photo? And he just wait. I like that photo. Like you think you're just having a conversation. And he goes, oh, cool. What was your name? And you tell him, oh, I'm Jim.
And then he signs it.
And he signs it to Jim Virgil. And he goes, that's $30. We should take a photo, though. And you go, what? And he goes, we should take a photo. And you take a photo with him. And he just keeps upselling. And these wrestling fans are so kind of like, there's so much nervous energy about wrestling fans.
He's hustling.
He just sees him coming a mile away and he shakes him down. Mm.
Wow.
I asked him if he's ever literally grabbed a wrestling fan by their ankles and just shook them until all the money in their pockets falls out.
He almost did that to Nicole, apparently.
He did. Yes, he did.
Holy shit.
Are you going to replay that interview? Or
It's on demand, and it's on YouTube at YouTube.com/NotSam.
Okay.
Me and Sam
it's
did
also
this
right evidence
together.
Right now for the DA's office, so you can catch it there.
We have Ian Ziering. He might stop by. That Sharknado 3 looked like a fucking... just a terrible movie.
It was a wonderful piece of cinema.
Did you see it?
Yes, I saw it.
We were talking about, was that on the air or off air? You were explaining...
off air. We were talking about off air. David Hasselhoff played his father.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It ended in space.
He ended up in space.
But yeah, and a shark actually ate, terroried in space. And then he
how did they get to space?
Spoiler alert.
See, now it's just starting to get silly.
And when they said,
how did they get to space?
They said in the movie, how did they survive in space? And he's like, how did they survive in a tornado? And that was the explanation.
That was, yeah.
Like, stop farting, Jimmy.
I didn't fart.
Oh, my God. You see what I'm saying? Busting ass again.
I said during the break, it smells like diarrhea in here, and I'm trying to figure out.
It's got something different in it. What did you eat last night?
Your farts smell different today.
Thank you.
They really do, though.
I didn't think anyone noticed.
I was telling these guys, I don't mind your farts because I've been smelling them for 15 years, so it just becomes...
It goes right in my mouth every time I turn this way.
It's when someone new farts in the studio, that's when it's brutal now. But it smells like diarrhea. I'm trying to figure out where,
no, it might
where
be it's coming from. Shit,
that was a good cloud, too.
You know what? Maybe I did. Anyway, so how do they get into space?
They were just flying out to space.
It doesn't matter. They've given up on any semblance of a script or a plot line. They're just like, wait. People like it more when it's just sharks in the sky.
I said,
what if we just do that? That's all we do.
They had it on the weather map. Sharks in the weather map. Like, this is what we expected.
How did they get into space, there were multiple Sharknadoes in the one movie. And they're all kind of leading off of each other. Like, there was the first one, and then the sequel, and then the third one. At this point, I was watching it, like, there would be more Sharknado storms than, like, rain in America if this were legitimate.
Sharknado. I loved it. Because it was so bad that you can't turn away. And that's when he's saluting his father, David Hasselhoff. Now, he's back on Earth, and David Hasselhoff on the moon, stuck.
He's stuck on the moon?
But somehow he saw him salute.
And he's happy.
Yeah, how could they salute each other? What the fuck?
It don't make sense, man, but it's great.
I had to...
Did it have a buzz, the Sharknado 3, like last year?
I didn't hear anything
year?
About it.
It wasn't quite like last year, but last it was definitely was a social media event.
Yeah, it was definitely all over Twitter.
And are they now eating birds to survive? The sharks are eating birds in the sky?
You got to. You're in the sky.
And that's how they're surviving?
It's disturbing.
I don't want to make everybody jealous. I had Bo Derek on my show.
Was she in it?
To promote it. Yeah.
Was her leg bitten off?
Tara Reid's mom.
How's she looking, Bo Derek?
She's looking all right. She's looking good.
Still get it?
Yeah.
How old is Bo Derek now?
Yeah.
Wikipedia says 58.
What's that?
She's a little tasty, though. Oh, yeah. Wait. Tara Reid gave birth inside the shark. And then she came out.
Right.
And it's the shark that fell from space.
What?
Yeah, that's the baby. He pulled the baby out and then grabbed him, like, pulled her out. April! And then fucking grabbed her arm and pulled out. It was great.
But Bo Derek was saying, because Bo Derek only filmed, like, she's in the whole movie.
Look at the baby, nigga.
I almost got in trouble for saying that on the train once.
That was nigger baby.
Did Ian Ziering come back from space in a shark, you were telling me?
Yes, and fell through, like, the outer layer. Of
But then here's the problem with that. Where does he land?
He landed on the ground and was still fine. And then he climbed out, and he was looking around for the other shark to find Tara Reid, who played, you know, April, whatever.
And she's got now, what, a chainsaw
and
arm?
And he's like, a chainsaw comes out first, and then she passes the newborn baby out.
Yeah.
And then he pulls her out.
But sharks are living creatures. There's no way they'd be able to breathe in space like that.
It's like this. Sharks are inside the space shuttle. We got to get out. That's what's the dialogue.
What?
They have gills. That's what people forget.
Don't breathe air.
And the thing went down to this. How did they get back to Earth?
They fell.
I mean, it's gravity.
But if you're by the moon.
Look at them flying out to space.
If you're up high, you fall down. That's what happens.
Yeah.
Duh.
It wasn't all the way by the moon. It was like satellite space.
Nah,
eventually you come back to Earth.
It wasn't all the way by the moon.
Gravity's going to bring you back.
Bo Derek was saying that she only had to film the thing for like two... She's in the whole movie, but 2 days of filming, and she was done.
And she was good.
And she was perplexed by the seriousness with which Tara Reid took it. She was like, she just went there as a goof. She didn't memorize any of her lines. Like, Bo Derek did not care about this movie. But she was like... wondering if Tara Reid knew what movie she was doing.
Because this is her real movie.
She was taking it seriously.
To her, this is serious.
Yeah, that's what sells the silliness of Sharknado.
But let's not forget that Tara Reid was trying to explain to Jimmy that the sharks weren't real.
And that when they cut her hand off, they did not use a legitimate cadaver's hand.
Oh, yeah.
She was saying that?
They
Jim was asking how they get the sharks to fly.
We had her in here, and she was trying to explain to Jimmy that the sharks aren't real. And Jimmy
wasn't understanding, and she continued. It was so uncomfortable.
I can't wait for
there's
an
no
animal.
Way there's anyone this stupid.
You're
I can't
an
wait
animal.
For
sir.
Ian Ziering to have to explain yeah. space technology to Jim today.
They would die in space.
I don't understand. The gills wouldn't,
yeah.
wouldn't help.
Yeah, I don't get it either. Oxygen.
Yeah, no,
there's a lot of people in this movie that you'd be like, "This, oh, they still alive."
Chris Jericho was in it.
Yeah, Jericho was in. And Jericho was in it. This is how little they put into this movie with the worst tattoo sleeve covers ever. Did you notice that? It was like flesh-colored arm wraps that you could see the line on his wrist. They didn't even put bracelets on him so you could cover up the
Why
fact that
Why wouldn't they let him just have his tattoo?
I don't know, because he was wearing flesh-colored armbands under his
oh,
Guy Fieri shirt the whole time.
He did have a Guy Fieri. Oh, yeah, look at that. You can see it in this.
It wait, no, he's wearing a shirt. That's supposed to be a shirt.
No, it's
flesh-colored.
There's no the
Who
collar.
Wears flesh-colored shirts?
No, it's not a shirt. It's just a cover.
It's supposed to look like a jerk, like Guy Fieri.
Whose tattoos are those? Who's the guy?
That's Jericho.
Wow.
Mark McGrath is in it.
Holy shit. Does
yeah.
that, does
Neo's family... in it?
Why? Neo, yes.
Neo is
Wait
in
minute,
it.
Does...
Why would they take Jared out of it?
Does Jim McMahon own his tattoos?
Hold on, let me answer this question. Because he might have, they thought he might have looked at pictures of children fucking. And this is a fun movie. They don't want, because pedophilia is not accepted in the Sharknado
But he
world.
Already he already filmed his part.
Oh, Jared? Yeah.
They asked me to be in this. Wait, I said no.
Was that him?
Is that right?
Nope.
They had a lot of celebrities in this damn thing.
That's Marie what? Menounos got eaten.
Yeah.
Lucky shark.
Just being a guy. You talk about Tommy Boy with Bo Derek?
Yes. Yes, I did.
All right.
Bo Derek could still get it.
She would get it. Absolutely. She's dating John Corbett, who's on Bobby Kelly's show.
That's right.
Who's on Sex and the City.
I saw her at the premiere. She was lovely.
Sex he's and drugs a tall and drink of water. Roll.
John Corbett.
John Corbett. He's on. He's on Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll with Bobby.
She was in 10.
Look what Bo.
Why she? I didn't
Wait,
realize.
Dennis Leary show?
Yes.
No, John Corbett.
I don't watch that shit.
Wow, look at that shot of Bo Derek.
That's a good shot.
Yeah, but see, she got to wear a dry shirt. You see her breasts.
You don't like that, Jimmy?
No, it's inappropriate.
Does Chip like it at least?
Fuck yeah!
Oh, cool.
Stick my pecker between them tits. Fucking cum in your eye.
So I don't know why Ian is coming in here the day after the big movie was on TV.
Are they going to sell it with the deleted scenes or something? I don't get that either.
Is it Ian or Ian?
Ian.
Ian.
Okay. Even though it looks like Ian, he wants it pronounced Ian.
He was in that, what movie was he in, like District 9?
He's not in District 9 for sure.
Oh, he wasn't?
He was in Sharknado 1 and Sharknado 2.
Oh, I thought he was
on 90210.
That's right. He was on Celebrity Apprentice. Maybe that's what you're thinking of.
Oh, I got a question about what you saw him on a Celebrity Apprentice?
Yeah.
When he wrote that dumb jingle?
Oh, yeah.
And wouldn't let it go?
He was a fucking asshole on Celebrity Apprentice.
Asshole about that stupid-ass song. Like, let it go, you fucking...
If you do not go... That's what I learned. You're right. If you don't go by Ian Ziering's way on Celebrity Apprentice, he doesn't want to be riding with you.
He's got a lot of attitude,
After
dude.
That man who might be our president let him on that show...
Ooh, yeah. Trump?
Trump? Yeah, Trump has my vote.
Boy, the Donald
Good
sure
thing
says
you don't
what's
vote.
On his mind.
Yeah,
he
I like
sure
that.
Does, Jimmy. We got a bunch of Donald Trump clips.
Jim's all segues today. He is segwaying Jimmy today.
Yeah. He's had it with Sharknado. Basically,
see
what he's telling
Donald
the world
has to say.
Yeah, he's segwayed into Daniel Bryan. He's segwayed into Trump.
Well, we got three. We got three clips we could do, or we don't do any of them. Donald doesn't regret giving out Lindsey Graham's number. Steve Doocy compares him to a Navy SEAL. Or we could do Donald Trump thinks giving out Lindsey Graham's number was presidential behavior. Or we could go with Donald Trump going after Anderson Cooper during an interview.
I want to know how he goes after Anderson Cooper.
Yes, yeah, let's go that
one. I fucking hate Anderson Cooper.
Where
whoa,
you going,
whoa,
Sam?
Whoa, whoa.
I saw the clip. It was great.
I want to see
because he was going after the media in general, and Anderson Cooper was too much of a pussy to defend.
He's such a dumb fuck.
To defend his profession.
Anderson Cooper don't got the balls to throw himself off a Madison Avenue building like his brother.
Did he really?
Yeah.
Oh, no. Why?
Jesus.
He killed himself.
Oh, my goodness.
When?
I'm a New Yorker.
I didn't wish evil on his family.
No, I'm wishing on him.
What happened?
Why?
He committed suicide.
But they were brought up privileged.
It's Vanderbilt's. Yeah, he's the Vanderbilt son. Yeah, he jumped off the...
He couldn't handle Vanderbilt's son.
Anderson Cooper.
He's a Vanderbilt?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
Gloria Vanderbilt's his mother.
So wait, why did they change the name to Anderson Cooper?
I guess to get away from that, his brother jumping off the building.
And it sounds more newsy.
Sounds more Jewy, that's why.
So he's had so much money. He's had money his whole life.
Yeah. He doesn't have to
work. Filthy rich.
He doesn't have to work.
Grew up on Madison Avenue with fucking Arnold and fucking Willis Jackson, moved with Mr. Drummond.
Who's his father? Wasn't there a rumor that, or maybe the rumor, what was the rumor with him?
Not the gay thing.
Like, who was his pops?
It's not a rumor.
He's gay?
He finally came out, and everyone was like, yeah, all right, so, relax. We all knew already.
Yeah,
like, that should have made...
We saw you clutching your pearls and wearing a brooch. We knew.
That right. should have made his ridiculous. Did you ever see that, when he tries to be funny on his... This is on my ridiculous, and he like giggles like a little girl.
Oh, yeah.
I do enjoy Anderson Cooper.
Though. I like him on 2020. I think he does good work over there.
Who is the guy who owned the Clippers that got caught on tape?
Thomas Sterling.
Dude, watching fucking Anderson Cooper pretend to be appalled when you can just see his little dick hard that he's getting this on tape.
That's right? True.
That was a bad one. At the same time, this is really upsetting. Like, keep going.
His dick's growing like Pinocchio's nose.
Where he goes, when he had those AIDS, you could see Anderson Cooper like just try to hold in the joy. He's just talking about AIDS.
I want to hear the Anderson Cooper.
Yeah, let's play it.
Yeah, play the old Donald on Anderson Cooper.
Media.
Well, among general voters...
I don't know. You keep bringing up negative. You only want to talk about negative. Why don't you bring up the positive?
Well, I did. I started off with the Washington Post poll.
You start off the interview with a poll that I didn't even know existed.
I started off with the Washington Post poll, intentionally, because I knew you would accuse me of that.
All I know is every poll I'm leading in, and you give me these two polls where it's different states. Right. They're not even a national poll.
We'll check the record. I started off with the Washington Post poll, where you are way out in front.
I think it's very unfair. You're talking to me a poll I never even saw. It's on three different states, and you're hitting me with this.
Okay.
And I think it's a very fair question.
Okay.
I think it's an extremely. You start off the interview with that. You don't say I've led in the Fox poll. I'm leading in the ABC Washington Post poll.
You're leading across the board.
Well, you did. I am leading across the board.
Right.
And then you hit me with this poll that I didn't even see before. Where, oh gee, it's not even that kind of a poll. All I know is I have a very big group of support. And I think one of the reasons is that, let me tell you, the people don't trust you and the people don't trust the media.
Oh.
And I understand why. You know, I've always been covered fairly accurately because it was usually a financial press. And, you know, numbers are numbers, okay? And my numbers happen to be great. With the media, it's... Some of the political media is great and really honest. Even if they don't want to be, really honest.
Sure.
But I find that 60-70% of the political media is really, really dishonest. And, you know, I tell the story, the American dream. I talk about the American dream in speeches. The American dream is dead, but I'm going to make it bigger and better and stronger than ever before. The American dream is dead, but I'm going to make it bigger and better, stronger than ever, right? And I go, boom, and I do it with great bravado, and the audience goes crazy. I come home, and my wife is saying, oh, darling, that was so bad. I said, what was bad? What did you say today? I said, what did I say? The American dream is dead. Cut. On one of the major networks.
Right. They are terrible.
They're horrible.
But Trump is coming off as a little pompous.
That could have been a scene
that's
in Sharknado.
That's what I like the best.
Somebody just saluted him from the moon.
I'm still watching Sharknado clips.
I'm going to tear out of America with a chainsaw.
Wait till he comes in here. I'm going to say, hey, I call that Trumpnado. What do you think, Ian? The Trumpnadoing the whole thing. He's in the shock, man.
I think Ian would love that.
I bet he would. For part four or something, you should have the Donald be a part of it.
It's a little joke we all can enjoy.
Yeah, it's something for everyone.
The media is helping Trump.
But they are repulsive, though. He's right. They do stuff like that. Like, the American dream is dead, and cut.
And Anderson Cooper didn't even defend that. He goes, and politicians. So he was acknowledging that.
But Trump has him there.
Shitty, but
yeah.
Because Trump's a fucking business jerk. So he's got on two fronts.
Mm-hmm. My numbers are terrific. What is
it? Are amazing or something. Yeah. He's just... Oh. We have other clips, but I guess that's good
He's
enough.
Enjoyable.
He's not backing out, though. That's what I like.
Nope.
Oh, I want him to get up to Hillary. I want him to be him
and
Hillary.
Fox News doesn't even want him. That's the best part
of it.
Of course
they don't.
That's what makes it fun, too.
Yeah. What do you think they want?
They want somebody who they control. Everybody wants. Like ABC wants. Like CBS wants.
They don't
want
a loose cannon representing
But if he's getting tremendous... If people are really saying, fuck the rest of the candidates, fuck them, they're going to have no choice but to...
There are a lot of people saying fuck the process. That's by showing support to Trump.
That's what I see.
Right? Yes. They said fuck the process.
I'll bring it all to the ground. I don't give a shit.
They said fuck everybody. Even if they fuck Fox.
I don't think that the process comes back from this. They're gonna have to change their ways. In future elections.
Dude, you
can't ignore what is going on with this.
I'm going Trump, or if a wrestler steps in, that's the only choices I'm going with.
I would vote for him, though. I really would. Even because it more is a big fuck you to the rest of them.
I was going
to
vote Ted Cruz as a fuck you, but this is a fuck you that like hits everybody.
You don't want Hillary with her fucking her Pez body old lady head attached to it?
It's only a one-sided fuck you, but I'm not against her. I think she's probably be more qualified than Trump.
Yeah, but
she has more experience, you agree or disagree with her politics.
And also her being such a political animal, we probably could have got single payer with her as opposed to Obama. Like, she probably would have got that shit done better, but...
Do you think it comes
you
up
let on... another one go, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
It comes up on Twitter a lot. Do you think...
When Ian gets here, I hope you get this under control.
Oh, my God.
I don't think it's a fartnado.
Ooh. I hope we aren't embarrassed.
Movie idea.
Yeah.
It comes up on Twitter a lot. Do you think a lot of people are saying that Trump doesn't even want to be president?
No, he's. That was last year. This is this
year. You think
year.
He really, truly wants
oh,
it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Sure, if he could. Like, if all of a sudden it starts to look like it might happen.
Oh, yeah.
First, I don't think Trump can hide what it is he thinks or wants. Like, I think he just says it.
He wants to be a winner.
Amazing.
Mm-hmm. He wants to be a winner. He don't want to lose, no matter what contest it
is. Yeah, he's not doing this for us.
Held on to that birthing thing for so long because he didn't want to lose.
It's not helping his brand.
That's even forgotten.
He's
nobody
10
even
billion.
Gives a shit. That he goes. Was it Trump who had like the secret evidence his
yes.
guys gathered?
And then he never gave it to the people.
Yeah, it was nothing.
Did he ever
what
say what
it
was?
What was it? I don't even remember.
I have some huge evidence.
Remember?
Barack Obama.
And on February 8th. Didn't he give a date when he was going to release it?
Oh, God. And it became like that Guns N' Roses album.
He's Barnum and Bailey, money.
Chinese democracy?
Yeah, Chinese took years.
He couldn't do any worse in 4 years than any of the other ones have done.
I agree.
It's because Congress and the Senate control everything. It's like he's got a certain amount of power. He's not going to ruin the whole system.
No.
Love to see him.
We'll be in the same place we are right now 4 years after Trump.
Just to hear him just barreling over this fucking polite dialogue these assholes always have.
Yeah.
What have you done?
Every time. Look at this fucking jerk off. Look at Marco Rubio. Every time he talks, it's just some fucking pablum like... And families are worried about fucking
something. I know,
something.
They stink,
and
these guys.
And Trump comes out and he's like, Mexicans are rapists. Holy shit. That guy does not give a fuck.
He gives no fucks.
How do you defend against that?
The debate's going to be great. I think the GOP is going to have a better debate set up than
are you kidding?
Democrats.
That bore Hillary is going to be a stiff, and the American people deserve change in the future.
In the last couple of days, I'm like all towards Trump now.
Yeah, I mean, I'm all in with Trump.
Well, he needs a running mate. Any names popping up yet?
How about this, Rosie O'Donnell?
Yeah, who does he take as a running mate? If it gets to that point.
I don't
who
even
does
know.
Who does he choose?
Rosie's going to keep me honest.
Does he choose a legit guy who people go, all right, this guy could be a...
But who's that legit that'll fucking counteract Trump?
Or who would put their career on the line with him?
Got to be an older guy that doesn't give up.
It's got to be somebody by the book. It got to be a by the book politician dude.
Yeah, maybe a Rand Paul or something. I mean, a Rand Paul Donald Trump. Maybe we get the tax code changed. A Rand Paul Donald Trump. You look at Rand as he's pretty political, and Donald Trump is the guy who tells it like it is. Very verbose. Donald
maybe
Trump,
the Federal Reserve can no longer. You know, there's people who are obsessed with the fucking Federal Reserve.
Yeah.
Like conspiracy level obsessed.
There's nothing in there.
There's nothing in there?
It's empty. It's Al Capone's vault, nigga.
It's just got some rainbow stew in there. Nothing else.
They got nothing.
Nothing. Zero.
Just nothing in there.
You're not fooling me. You're not fooling me.
They have us all tricked.
Fort Knox and all that. Stop. Fort Knox.
Let's call their bluff.
Stop it.
Let's call their bluff.
Let's go down there right now. It's empty. Fucking empty in there. It's sad.
I do like the tax, though. That he wants to do the flat tax, which is what Forbes pushed years ago.
Do you think that we could ever get that?
17% flat tax, I think, is very fair.
But do you think that could actually happen?
No. The IRS wouldn't allow it because
it puts a lot of them
out of business.
I think eventually it will.
It seems like it simplifies things too much, but then you can't take write-offs. You just pay 17%, I think. And it's like, okay. I mean, we're taxed on everything. It's fucking terrible.
Then I'm for that, but people against it would tell you that it's like on poor people, that they also, because you know how the tax is like a progressive higher tax now?
Right.
That's the people who argue against it. They're like, that will hurt the poor.
But it's like if you have $100 and you pay 17 in tax.
I think it's a good idea.
That's very fair.
Yeah. Because everybody has to buy stuff.
But was like that everybody. Federal or state? Or just everything altogether?
I think just everything.
So you would mean New York, Texas is going to be the same as Tennessee? That can't be right.
Oh, no, maybe it's federal. I'm guessing.
It's federal. It's,
would it cover everything, though?
Don't know.
No.
But know then once it. You pay that 17%, then you got to still pay state tax.
But again, maybe that would be a flat percentage.
So that's two flatties coming out of your check. So you got 17. You
well, maybe that covers everything. I don't know, to be honest with you, Shrek. I don't know. I can't answer that question. I just don't know it.
Yeah, I don't know either.
But Rand Paul does, because I think a Rand Paul Donald Trump ticket.
He wants to take a chainsaw, right, to the tax code?
Yeah, he's right, though.
Was that on TV yesterday?
That's a commercial.
We get fucked so hard and so terribly by the system like that. It's just awful.
And when you think like 50% of the Americans don't pay taxes, then it's like, what?
It's not like you get. They don't pay income tax.
Income
they pay
tax.
Payroll
income tax.
Right. Everybody pays payroll tax.
Because they tax it before you get it.
Right.
Tax your money that you already were taxed on.
Yeah.
When you got left, and they taxed that again. How the fuck is that fair?
I'm looking at buying a place, and I looked at new construction recently, and this is one of the taxes you got to pay. If it's new construction, you have to pay a mortgage transfer tax, which is like 1.85%. It's just transferring the deed to you from the sponsor who makes the building to the new people.
Were they Time Warner Cable with a service fee?
Dude, it's fucking disgusting. It's 1.85%. To the, for what?
Yeah. You're just throwing that away.
For what?
Yeah.
Fuck it. It's like a mafia vig, these scumbags.
And these politicians, voted this in because we wanted it, I guess. We, the people, wanted that to happen to us.
No.
I'm being sarcastic. Yeah. What the fuck?
That's like...
Yeah.
You know, and then I don't get the tax. See, that's a stupid tax. But
I can't
believe that. Remember they were going to put like a 25-cent tax or a 5, maybe it's 5 cents on fucking soda? And then there were ads on TV with some fatso townie like, if they raise the price of pop and soda, I won't be able to feed my family sugar water like they're hummingbirds. And then fucking, you think fatsos are going to not buy their fatso syrup for it because it's 5 cents more? It's a drug. Like, I bought my cigarettes every time.
Yeah, they raise them. You know what? If you're taxing cigarettes and making them put warnings, why not all these sugary drinks and stuff like that? Like,
you could
become a fat burden and fucking then you show someone with no leg due to diabetes. That should be the picture.
Coca-Cola raises the price like a fucking dollar every other year. Like, why is 5 cents a problem?
I don't know. Those damn cokers.
Going back to Trump, it just was on TV. I wrote it down to make sure I don't fuck this up. Trump just said, I have a great relationship with blacks.
Can he you does now.
Did he make Louis Black and his family?
Well, there's a word for that. I need to find that. We got to play it for the people.
And now Leslie Graham said something. Was it Leslie Graham? One of them said
Lindsay.
Something. Lindsay.
Leslie Graham, yeah.
He said, I was in Wendy's the other day, standing behind two African-American fellas. And they said, they turned to me and said, you better run. They said, I think that's the governor behind me. And they said to me, you better run.
And they had a gun pointed at me.
That's what they should have had. It's like whenever they talk about black and how they relationship, it always comes off disingenuous.
Go to that first clip. I don't even know if there's anything there. The Daily Beast, the dumbest stuff Donald Trump has ever said.
He's got some good ones.
Is it an easy list to go through real fast? On African Americans, I have a great relationship with the blacks. I've always had a great relationship with the blacks. He said it twice. Laziness is a trait in blacks. Did he actually say that?
No, let's see.
I guarantee it's one of those media chops. I guarantee you that's one of those media chops.
Where they just edited it?
Yeah, of course. He might have said laziness is a trait of blacks, and then like been discounting that or something, and they fucking
trying to keep it as his statement.
He might have been repeating a question. Mm-hmm. Like, do you think blacks are is laziness a trait in blacks? Is laziness a trait in blacks? What are you talking? And then
a
they
question
cut
from
it.
Me.
But you know what I mean? They do that shit, man. They're the worst.
That's why I can't trust them. Everybody's so sneaky.
I trust them as far as I can throw them.
All right, why don't we figure that out during the break? We got a lot of stars in the room today. Jim Norton's going to be at Levity Live starting tonight. I know that.
Yeah.
I also know that Kurt Metzger is going to be at the Stress Factory starting tonight, right?
Yeah. 7:45.
And also, not to mention my Netflix special. My special hits Netflix today.
That's today, right?
Yeah, so I don't know what time
it's Netflix day.
Yeah.
So go get Jim Norton's special on Netflix.
I'll be in town all week doing shows.
Just hanging. All right.
I'm doing Shepherd next week, too. Shepherd Smith.
How is Shepard Smith?
He's a good dude.
He's all right. I take a peek at his show every once in a while.
Yeah, he's all right.
He keeps it a little more fun than the others.
He is looser than the rest of us.
A little more
remember
fun.
That Bill Hader would do him. He goes, "I'm Shepard Smith, and I come from a small town full of secrets."
See, it's not even fair. In his 1991 book, Trumped, the former president of Trump Plaza Hotel and Casino, John R. O'Donnell, recalled Trump declaring that laziness is a trait in blacks. So,
see, that's a lot of third person.
Yeah, no shit. So we knew there was something behind that.
It's a trait in everyone.
Black guys counting my money, I hate it. The only kind of people I want counting my money are little short guys that wear...
Yeah, I'm a Jew. Yeah.
Yes, every day.
I mean, that could have been a Chris Rock joke.
Trump acknowledged in a Playboy interview.
Trump acknowledged?
Yeah. That he wants Jews to handle his money?
Yeah.
All right.
He's got my vote.
And absolutely. My accountant is very Jewish, and I trust him. I trust his judgment. I trust his integrity. Yeah. No offense, Sherrod. I mean, I would have a black accountant. I really would.
Oh, black people are accountants, too.
Yes,
and Jewish,
course.
By the way.
That's right. Sammy Davis came back to life and wanted to do my books. I'd let him and that one good eye take a quick peek. Take him twice as long as the regular guy.
And then he says the stuff O'Donnell wrote about me in that
still
book
got it, nigga.
Is probably true. So he's saying that's probably true, what he wrote in that book.
Who said that?
Trump.
He said that what the dude wrote about him is probably true.
In general, he said the stuff O'Donnell wrote about me is probably true. So
were they friends at one point? Or?
I don't know.
I'm making love.
I don't know. And, all right, I guess we'll take a break then. Oh, on the YouTube channel, OP Radio, we put up Warren Haynes doing Jim Norton's request yesterday.
That was so good, wasn't it, when he did that?
Well, no. I didn't think Haynes. He was going to do it.
I think
we pressured him.
We probably did, but I heard the beginning riffs to, it's a great song, and Warren Haynes is just fucking
amazing. What's the name
amazing.
Of the song again?
It's Forevermore.
Forevermore, right. So you can check that out on OP Radio on YouTube. And
nice.
Then we were lucky enough that Mark Norman had a camera crew in here. So when he told that masturbation story.
Oh, yeah.
No one believed me. On Race Wars, I brought up, he was like, what are you, just making that?
Sounds
did he just
like
make it up?
Right.
They talked to me. They thought I was a sucker. I'm like, I really believed it.
Yeah. And we got that story up on the YouTube channel as well.
Okay.
Allegedly. The guy gave up his footage for us, so I appreciate that. It's up there now.
He better, or we'll fucking sue him.
That's right.
I'd rather see the footage of, then Mark said he taped it?
Yeah.
Where's the tape?
That's the footage I want.
Where's the tape then? If it's not a bit.
Yeah. I think he said his father jerks off to it. Why would I say that? Yeah. But Mark, that wouldn't it bother Mark. Funny. Mark would go, hey, he does. Perfect voice. Go ahead,
hey, unhand that penis. There's a lady's hand coming in.
The best part, he slapped the hand lightly. Shoo, get out of there. That's how he talks.
He almost has a little Dan Natterman in him.
Yeah, a
little bit, a little taste of that.
You mean autism?
Yeah. Asperger's?
With that, we'll be back. Man, Sherrod.
That's right.
Last man standing.
Yeah, it is.
Lost Kurt, lost Jim Norton.
I did not know that Chris Elliott's daughter was caught up in that whole pitcher scandal.
I didn't know until you just showed me.
Wow.
She's all right.
She's a cutie.
Why is she putting her finger in her hiney?
No, that wasn't her, was it?
I don't know. I think that might have been her putting her finger in her hiney.
Was that her putting a finger in the hiney?
In one of the leaked photos.
You don't know, but what they say it is?
You never can tell if there's no face attached to it.
Right.
Because it could be anybody, but they had it in the same category as the legit photo that was hacked.
That middle finger's going to smell a little stanky.
I'll give a little whiff to it. Get me through the week.
You know what else I'll tell you something else I learned yesterday. You know Ella King?
Ella King.
X's and O's. It's a big pop song right now.
Okay, yeah.
Kind of sounds like Adele.
Showtime uses it all the
Amy
time.
Winehouse. Showtime uses the song.
Right.
That is Rob Schneider's daughter.
What?
How did I not know that? Someone hit me up with that on Twitter yesterday.
Is it really?
I had to look it up. I'm like, you are so fucking with me. There it is. It's Rob Schneider's daughter.
How old is she?
20. What did they say yesterday?
She looks 26. Very weathered,
yes.
She got a 26?
26. That is Rob Schneider. Wow. Okay. Yeah. All right. I see the Rob Schneider face. Okay. That bleached blonde hair is not fooling anyone.
Now, Rob Schneider's a Filipino, ain't he?
He's got a little something in there.
I mean, he's Filipino.
A little something extra in there. But you know the song, though, right?
I think so.
Can we give them a taste? Can we give the Sherrod a little taste? People really, a lot of people yesterday, like, what was that song you started the show with? I'm like, really?
She also does a good cover of Tom Petty's American Girl.
Okay.
Oh, can I hear that?
That's on YouTube. You can.
You know what? We'll play that into break. Remind me, okay?
Good for her, you know, making a name for herself.
The song is one of the hottest songs out right now as far as the pop songs go.
That's his daughter. So that's his only kid, or?
I don't know.
I never even knew any.
Even as I tell you this, I still don't believe it's Rob Schneider's daughter.
You remember you saw the movie Grown Ups?
Yeah, yeah.
Remember he had those hot daughters? He had those hot daughters in that movie, remember?
Did you like? No, I don't, because I don't remember the movie. It was horrible.
Really?
I hated Grown Ups. And there's a lot of talented people in those movies. I fucking hated Grown Ups. I hated Grown Ups too.
It was more like a family type of.
I agree with you. I hate Grown Ups.
Oh, Jimmy. He's on fire today, man.
What happened?
What are you pushing out today?
Good God almighty.
I have to travel today, so those are my driving blues.
I just want to know why it smells like diarrhea in here.
This motherfucker is letting it go today.
I think I'm getting punked or something. What's going on? Because I'm the only one that smells the diarrhea, really?
Oh, no.
That was a bad one?
No.
No, it wasn't.
Maybe your farts smell a little different today.
No. No, Jimmy.
Can't help it.
That one was just too ripe.
Those are the driving blues. I'm pushing them out.
Oh, my God. It goes right in my mouth. I'm right next to this son of a bitch. We gotta get a fan in here, man.
I'm sniffing. Preferably a chick who can suck my dick while I'm farting.
I'm sniffing cautiously because now I want to know why you're so bothered.
Oh no!
It takes a while to come to my side. So far, I'm good.
I don't even know what headphones I'm putting on.
No, I'm good.
Oh,
I don't think
Jim.
It's gonna make it this way.
Where are you going today?
I have to go to Nyack.
Levity Live.
Levity,
okay.
Oh, I got to wish my my father a very happy birthday.
Oh.
Yes, Don Imus is 75 years old today.
75.
He's told a bunch of people that he banged my mom in the parking lot at Nassau Coliseum.
Did he really say that?
And that I'm his son.
Yeah. Did he really do that?
I don't know. It's possible, I guess.
It's definitely possible. You know your mother.
There's a couple pictures out there of me and Imus hanging out, and he certainly looks like he could be my father.
Really?
A little bit.
I gotta see the pictures.
What's up, Kurt?
75. Did you ever call black girls nappy-headed hoes? Maybe that could be called.
Did you have a problem with that?
No.
As a comic?
No.
Thank you. You could stick around.
I said the same thing about the USR soccer team. I saw those nappy-headed hoes taking pictures.
Don't you think it hurt those girls as huge Imus fans, the Rutgers?
Oh, they weren't Imus fans.
Just because he's on the $20 bill, he thinks he can talk that way.
That one is just ridiculous.
Yep.
Oh, man. Imus is 75.
75, ain't
Holy
that crazy?
Fuck.
That is nuts.
We got, you guys want to hear a little video of a woman going off on learning how to speak English?
Hell yeah.
She's ranting, learn how to speak English.
She's ranting about not being able to speak English?
Well, she's ranting against a parking attendant. I hate the parking attendant.
Yeah. Oh, I remember. Is this a chick from...
Not a fan. This is a newer one.
Dude, you know what it is? I don't mind if you don't learn English. Like, because I always deal with fucking drivers that suck if I'm trying to get a car service from the ghetto I live in. But, I don't care if you learn the language, but if you don't know the language and then you fuck up, don't act like it's my fault. You know what I mean? Like, I'm not, like, you hear with an accent, too? I'm not fucking...
Yeah.
just acknowledge maybe you made the mistake as the guy that doesn't speak the language.
Of course.
Right.
Like, yeah. I don't know where I live. I gave you the wrong address from my own house.
You said, I'm like, dude, I go here every day. Why would I lie about my work address? I didn't.
No, I had a fucking guy. I had this fucking Uber driver. I'm on the line with him. He goes, I am here. I'm like, buddy, I'm standing outside. You're not on the right street. I know which street I live on.
Yes.
This guy argued with me for like 10 minutes before he figured out he's two blocks away. How would I walk out of my house on a different street? Like, how would that be possible?
And not know where you are.
Yeah. Learn English.
Yeah. Well, this is going a bit viral today. You got the woman goes on learn how to speak English rant.
Oh. Why don't you learn how to speak English, you fucking idiot? Learn how to speak English, you fucking idiot. Learn how to speak English. Learn how to speak English, you fucking idiot. I know, you can't speak English. You're an idiot. Yeah, you're garbage.
Fuck yeah. Fuck you.
You're garbage.
I hate her.
What happened right before that, though?
You just know when you... I said it yesterday. Yeah. You just know when you have to hate somebody.
Yeah.
I don't know.
She looks hateable.
I want to know, because that camera went on. Something was happening.
Yeah.
True.
So I want to know what happened.
What happened? Right. Take her off?
Again, she might just be a cunt, but normally you don't go to, speak English, you're garbage. There's usually a lead up.
The guy said, will that be all for today?
Speak English, you're garbage. Stop with your foreign courtesy.
So are you trying to say that wouldn't be your opening line?
No, that's why. I don't know if it's deserved or not.
I'm trying to find common ground first.
Imagine if you were that guy, that's your opening line.
Yeah.
I saw it. Nothing has
to happen for you to just say that.
I saw a girl at a pizza place. I had to take Karen to the hospital for, she's all Crohn's.
Yeah, Crohn's.
So I'm going to get something to eat while I'm waiting for them to check out her fucking pretzel gut problem.
Yeah, and she's twisted up in a gut.
Yeah, she's got Crohn's, my girlfriend. So it's, Yeah, so I go, so I'm going to get something to eat, and so I felt bad for this foreign guy behind the counter, because there's two drunk NYU girls, and the girl kept going, my friend, what's that? She's pointing at broccoli on a pizza. My friend, what's that called? Can you turn up the music? My friend.
No one wants to be called my friend. No.
I'm watching this guy. He's like, if this was my country, I could beat you with this pizza paddle. Legally. If I was back in a decent country, I could beat, and who could argue with him?
And no charges would be,
No.
It would be a hero brought up.
They'd charge her if the paddle broke over her head.
We could charge her for the panel.
Pay for this, you witch whore.
All right, let's go back to this.
You're garbage. Look at how much of a loser you are. That's what you do. You stand here all day and you swipe cards, you garbage. You're garbage. Why don't you pucker those lips up for your fucking whore bag wife?
Wow.
Whoa.
Oh, he was kissing that.
Piece of garbage.
Fuck yeah.
We don't know what he did.
She's
first.
Right.
But we've been in parking garages. What could, I mean, you know, people are annoying, but what could this guy have possibly have done?
If he get it to things. The, if to he get fucked it to me this on, point. If he fucked me on $2, that's worth saying.
Yeah, this video needs to just, you know,
I need an
explanation.
An explanation would be nice, because I don't know.
But she's definitely going in, and don't like he's trying to calm the situation either. He's like, he's kissing at her and
hear
shit.
What he's saying.
But he's kissing at her.
Where's he from? They don't
know. That's
I
like
don't know,
that's
a place for kissing some
egging it on.
I gotta hear more from
Tim. Yeah, what else? You're garbage. You're garbage. Go home and kiss your ugly wife. You're garbage.
Why is it viral? Is that like another white guilt thing that I'm supposed to feel?
Maybe.
I don't.
She's
the principal of a school.
This is what privilege looks like.
That's right.
Calling an attendant garbage.
Yeah, how do we know about this video today? That's a good point. Yeah. Really good question by Kurt there.
Adrian.
I found it on a sports blog and just thought it was a funny video.
Okay. Yeah. All
right. Well, so what else happened?
Maybe it's not even viral. Maybe we're making it viral. Maybe no one even knows about this.
First time anyone's hearing about it.
All right. So we're guilty of that, too.
You're garbage.
You guys want to see the rest of it?
More than I want to breathe.
What else do you think we're going to do?
He's a piece of garbage.
Honestly, just stop it.
Look at the fucking piece of garbage here.
Yeah,
he's
going in, though.
Nothing. I just want him to know that he's a piece of shit. I know. You're such a piece of shit.
We got to point out the guy, because this is a typical New Yorker, doesn't want to get involved. And just make him believe he's not seeing this, which is a mere 8 inches to his left. He's trying to figure out his bill. You see that? He's like looking at his...
Is that a parking attendant thing? It's a parking attendant.
That's what it looks like.
You sure?
I don't know. No, I'm not
sure. Signing. He might be signing his...
It's not, I was thinking Subway Metro card person, or but no, this probably is a parking attendant.
I think it's a parking attendant,
Well, a Metro MTA employee would make a lot more sense.
Yeah.
To be that hateful towards...
But these garage dudes are sometimes assholes, too.
Yes.
I know that. It's hard
But in what way? I mean, they're not pleasant, but
they'll
what way...
They'll walk right past you and go get other people's cars while you're still there waiting. Yeah. I have that many a time. I'm like, this motherfucker, you see me, right?
Or you see your car, you're like, can I just jump in and go?
Yeah.
And you got to wait your turn. It's like, but it's right there. Just give me the fucking
keys. Garbage. Can I get in my car, you stupid garbage?
I think that the garages should give your car back an order of race.
That's the topic of the next week's Race Wars.
Oh my God, can we make a button of your garbage for the show?
You're garbage.
Garbage.
You're garbage.
Human garbage.
I want to hear.
Piece of garbage.
I want to see the dude, too. Do we ever get to see the dude at all?
No.
Let's push play on this.
Back to your country where you belong.
Oh, she's in
garbage. Wrong.
So ignorant. Here.
I like your hat.
Thank you, sir.
I don't care if I'm ignorant. He's ignorant. Okay. Piece of shit.
I don't care.
Miss, say what he just did to you.
Can you fucking please scan this, please, sir? No, you don't want to? Shocking. They can only hire pieces like shit.
All
right.
Like
pieces right. Like no shit. One cares.
Is she with her?
I don't think so.
No.
Now scan it. It's good. Come on. Yeah, he's good.
Oh, yeah.
That's a dude taping.
They might be together, those two, don't?
Yeah, I think they are.
I think
they're together.
I don't think she's going to get her car anytime soon.
Well, the other lady was like, he wasn't scanning something
for her either, it seemed.
I bet they might have been together. I don't know.
So now, you think it was an anti-lesbian situation?
I don't know.
Let me ask this question. So she's acting up like that. You're the dude. You come out of the booth and you punch her. Now what happens?
You go to jail.
I mean, obviously you lose your job, but would people go, yeah, she probably deserved that?
No, she's just verbal. It's just verbal.
Yeah, you can't assault someone.
You can still call someone a nice C word once in a while.
Yeah.
You know?
Once he got off, though, once he left his job. He didn't call name call it back, but it sounded like he was antagonizing her with kisses.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's trying to make it better. It's her kisses.
And she's like, was that a lesbian relationship? That might be even more insulting if he's kissing at her.
Did you ever have I had a taxi driver when I was in the cellar point, like in the village, he's pointing at dudes holding hands, like, you believe this? Hey, hold hands. You see this? Like, is this your first trip to the city, sir? Yeah, they do that.
Classic.
Ian is here. Yeah,
let's get it's Ian. Not even Friday prayer.
Yeah, bring him in. We got Ian Ziering.
Okay.
Making his way into the studio.
Here we go.
The star of Sharknado, Ian Ziering.
Nice.
Wiped out this morning, but
wiped out. Why are you wiped out from fighting all the sharks?
It's a big premiere last night.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, it was a big premiere. What were you doing during the while we were all watching the movie?
I was at a viewing party here in Manhattan. Yeah, watching it for the first time myself.
Oh. Where was the viewing party?
Where was I? You know,
and why
I got
weren't
in
we
a car
invited?
And I got out of car and then where it was.
No. Was Bill Cosby there?
No. No, I didn't see him like everyone else.
Well, we have a script called Cosby-Nado. Just listen.
Yeah, this quailer is flying through there.
Hear us out.
Script a little blurry or what?
Well, Sharknado 3 got really crazy.
Crazy.
Yeah, I'm going to make believe I saw it. I didn't see it.
I didn't see it yet. David Hasselhoff on the moon, you selfish son of a bitch.
I will go back to retrieve his cold, freeze-dried corpse. Don't worry.
In part four? Yeah.
I don't know. I'm making it up like they do everything else.
I did see clips, though. You're waving to...
he saluted him.
Saluting him.
Salute.
How is he seeing the salute if he's on the moon and you're on Earth,
I think,
sir?
It's just symbolic.
Yeah. Okay.
Indicative of the love, father-son love.
Okay.
You know,
from wherever they are, they salute, you know?
Yeah, but some of these plot lines are getting a bit unbelievable.
And you know, you're overthinking it. You really are. You need to, you know...
The baby, Tara Reid passes you the baby from the shark.
Well, she...
I didn't know how that was going to play out. We shot that so many different ways, with her coming out... Handing me the baby.
No, like the
baby's
born
comes
out of the shark.
I know, it's
that's
like,
great.
They like Roots.
So
it's
gross.
Like Roots, but out of shark with a baby getting held up in
the
air.
It was as shocking to me as it was the rest of the world.
Your acting is great.
Well,
for something so silly.
You know, this is,
I must admit.
We shoot this in 15 days, so.
What?
15 days.
The whole movie.
I didn't think it would take that long.
There's not much time for rehearsal, so we do all our workshopping before and make it happen. So thanks for that.
It's amazing that from the first one, it came like this media frenzy of people talking about Shark Day. It was just such a silly, fun thing, and the media really helped on this one because they talked about it on every show before it happened.
Social media just blew it up.
But Today Show too. Everybody from the Today Show were talking about it. When I was walking here, I heard them talking about it.
I think they're all pissed because they all got eaten.
But why this one? Because there's always been a lot of silly, campy type movies, and this one just exploded.
Yeah, remember Snakes on a Plane was the one that was like, this is like the dumb movie to say. Like, Sharknado did three sequels.
And, the buzz on Sharknado.
No, four's coming out.
Movie, sequel, threequel.
But why do you think this one, out of all the
I don't know. I wish I knew what the secret ingredient was. I would be producing these movies and making the money.
Because you know why, dude? Nobody believes. You know how they just try to sell sharks to you? Like, they're not. Sharks are not dangerous. And then, like, sharks just murder people on stop. People don't buy that shit. And finally, a movie tells the truth.
There's a sense of realism to what we're doing. So people, finally understand. You're right.
These animals are deadly.
We're telling
people
the truth
didn't know.
It's more of a documentary.
And with climate change coming?
How's Tara Reid doing?
She's great.
Yeah, we had her in here last year for Sharknado too, and she was trying to explain to someone in studio that the sharks weren't real.
Yeah,
she was trying to explain it.
There are no sharks really in the movie. We're dodging. Well,
someone in studio didn't believe her, and then she continued to try to explain it.
Right.
Yeah, I really gave it to her. I was like, but the sharks.
You had her going.
Huh? Oh yeah.
Oh, we had her going. It was an amazing moment.
She was very nice. She thought I was a blithering idiot. She was trying to be nice about it. Like, oh God, this guy's a fool.
Right. Who's playing who here? Right.
We had fun with her. She's cool.
Yeah, she's really nice.
She did a great job last night. I think she is part of one of the most amazing movie endings in the history.
Yeah, so how's it going to go? Who's going
to
vote?
It's up to everyone out there. You know what? They can determine how this is all going to go.
But since this is America, we all going to hashtag dead. You know that.
You think so?
That's what we ruined.
Let me tell you something. Yeah. People will riot.
Right.
Hashtag what?
Because you got to determine what's the
what happens to Tara Reid.
April lives. Hashtag.
What was it, like a piece of plane or the space shuttle?
Oh, they shot it two ways. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, we fade to black just before anything happens. So you don't know if it takes her out.
When will they show the actual ending? Are they reshowing it?
They're not going to. That is the ending of the movie.
No, I mean, they don't have two alternates that they're going to show in the second time it airs.
It means there's a Sharknado 4.
Okay.
That's what Ian is saying here.
All right. Right. Okay.
And then you decide how she, whether she lives or dies, and I guess that would be the first scene from Sharknado 4.
Sharknado. Yeah, exactly. That would be the opening scene of the next movie,
I would think.
Sherrod's right, though. Everyone's going to go for dead.
Because the first one,
and then you guys are going to mess with the voting, and she's going to live.
No, I hate
how this works.
They wouldn't do that.
This is science fiction, so anything can happen.
Okay.
Yeah.
But, they're not going to mess with the voting. It is what it is. They have to be accountable to that.
But they had you coming through space and falling through the atmosphere.
In a shark.
Yeah, but the shark.
Because I'm a bit of a badass. Who uses a shark as a heat shield for re-entry into the
Earth's atmosphere? Vladimir Putin.
Yeah, that's how you came back to Earth. But then you land. I mean, why not have the shark land in the water? So then it'll be a little more believable that you survived that.
Yeah. You're also overthinking this.
You're also a heat shield. You need tiles for a heat shield.
No, you can use a great white. You can use a great white. I proved it last night.
Yeah.
Yeah. Their white belly reflects heat. A lot of people
and I guess
that.
The teeth maybe, but I wouldn't feel safe.
When there's no choice, you got to do what you got
to
do.
Yeah, get back. That's true. Why couldn't you get back in the spaceship?
Ripped it apart. Wasn't really an option.
Yeah.
Okay.
All the sharks were slamming into the spaceship, ripping it apart.
Did they have any problems breathing in space?
No.
Did the minus 300 degrees temperature affect them?
That, nor the pressure, nor anything else really can stop a Sharknado. Clearly, this is a cataclysmic event that happens in the water, in the air, and now in space.
How did you, when you first saw the script, how did they contact you for this? And they said, look, this is what we want to do. Or did you audition for it? Or did they go, look, we'd love to
this
do
was this. A straight offer.
It was.
And they
but
were,
what were you thinking?
I was thinking, oh, great, let me read this. And I started reading it. And just told my wife that this is no. Well, you know what? In science fiction, the line item in the budget for visual effects is enormous. It's so expensive to create these.
How much was it to fly to space?
Oh, probably about $6,000 on the budget that they had. The first script had so many holes in it that were left to be filled by visual effects. I didn't think that they were going to be able to accomplish this.
Right.
So I told my wife, I can't do this. And she said, no, you need to go to work. We're having a baby in April, so get to it, husband.
Goddamn wives.
Yeah, well, funny. You know, as
that's
a
funny. The wife pushed
husband,
him. Hey, shark boy, go to work.
Exactly. Right. Enough of this Chippendales. Go to work.
So you were just thinking payday at first, and then it becomes this phenomenon.
No, I was thinking, you know, as an actor, I get my health insurance through my union.
Right.
And every year you have to make the quota to qualify.
Right.
So the pay was just enough to make my quota in early January as an actor. I never know where my next gig's going to be. Mm-hmm. So I figured, wow, all right, you know, she's right. I got to take one for the team. I didn't think anyone would ever see this movie. It was going to be swept under the carpet. Yeah. I didn't know there was a sci-fi connection. I didn't think, honestly, anyone would ever see this.
Yeah.
That's amazing. She pushed you and she was right, like, because it became this kind of this thing that everybody loves, and it's really
turned
great
into
move.
A Sharknado. You know, just astonishing. And no one's more surprised than me, really.
Yeah,
and there's no pressure to make it. It has to be entertaining, but there's no pressure to make a fact line up with another fact. That's probably the fun part of writing it or doing it.
You know, when you're starting with a bad movie to begin with, it can only go up. Yeah. And you know what? That's the way we operate. The movie is campy, cheesy, delicious, satirical.
Ed Wood would go crazy for these.
You're right.
He would love it. Like, honestly, he would be out of his mind for these. It's perfectly believable a shark would come. And he would love that.
You know, this is a format. This is a recipe that every network is now clamoring of.
Yeah.
You can be sure that every network meeting, how did they do it? How are we going to do it?
I just saw like a sharktopus versus wolf whale, a whale wolf.
They're trying.
That's a real thing.
They're trying to get their own Sharknado. It's not happening yet.
Right, right.
Half shark, half octopus.
Yeah. But you know that they're going to throw out ideas that they're never going to go through. How about Junado? No! No!
I'm lobbying for Frogpocalypse now.
Frogpocalypse.
And now there's going to be a fourth movie. I can't imagine what you could possibly do in the fourth movie.
Oh, you can do more.
Now that you're been to space and back with sharks.
Thunder Levin, our writer, is very creative. He's very imaginative.
There you
what's
go.
Nice is they just they'll innovate. They'll
that's
do something
a real thing.
Different.
Sharktopus versus whale wolf.
Whale wolf.
Whale wolf. You think that was bullshit?
That's
a real
like,
thing. That
come on. Is this
out?
Sharktopus
TV? Versus. I watched it 2 days ago.
It sounds like a couple, and that's their pet names for each other.
Sharktopus.
Sharktopus.
Is that sci-fi? Is that
it smells like
sci-fi?
Fish.
Yeah, it's on sci-fi. It's on sci-fi. They played it like a couple nights ago.
Well, right
after Dino wolf. Oh no, Dino shark.
But it's not getting the same buzz.
Well, Dino shark is a science thing, is it? No.
Well, not in this movie, was it?
They aired Lavalantula last night after.
What was that?
That was a Steve Guttenberg movie.
Yes.
That, you know, they have high hopes for it, but you never really know what's going to resonate with the fans that are out there.
Right.
What's it about? Lavalantula.
Big Lava Spider.
Yeah.
Oh. It's a spider.
Now, did you guys go to Comic-Con and all that, too?
We did. This was the second year that we were at Comic-Con. Right. Actually, the third year, but this was the second year that I was there. And you know what? This is a movie that was made popular by the people. So the network... NBC Universal doesn't go out beating people over the head. See this movie. This is the best movie in the world. Those comments are coming from the fans.
Fans, that's amazing.
So it's very organic, and the excitement has been building for a year. Anticipation for this movie has just grown, not just here in the United States, but globally.
Yeah.
Hadn't, like, Science Fiction Channel or whatever been making a bunch of movies like that up until Sharknado that maybe didn't even take off? Like,
they,
it was always a giant thing. Like, that's the one that, like, hit for them, Sharknado, right?
It's, you know what? This is, really leading the network. This is what's helping build the network.
Yeah.
Sci-fi's been around for a while with these campy movies, but you know what? They've really captured lightning in the bottle.
Yeah, they hit a nerve with this one.
Well, because the first one they made where it's not like a bunch of Marines up against a monster. Like, they just remade Aliens 50 different ways with all those movies with, like, a giant thing, and they finally made one.
What was the shark that was eating people under the sand or something? I saw part of that, too.
Oh, that was Hasselhoff. Wasn't Hasselhoff in that one, too?
I don't know. There was Ghost Shark. There was all these other...
Ghost Shark.
Ian, you know the history of all shitty movies, right?
most of them, anyway.
Actually, it was a Baywatch episode where Hasselhoff had to kind of get somewhere under the sand.
Yeah, run. Yeah, and they go to slow motion, and he's...
But he's under the sand, and he has to get somewhere else.
Yeah, I remember that now. Okay.
Wow.
Celebrity Apprentice. Trump is in the news.
What's
your thoughts on Trump? You got to hang with him a bit.
You know what?
He said he got everything from you.
Clearly.
His thoughts about Mexicans.
He's called me to see if I'd run on the ticket with him. And,
some of the stuff he's saying, we feel like could have been in Sharknado, by the way. That could have been a nice
little
scene.
You know, whether you agree with the things that he said or not, or, you know, the guy's definitely capable. Look what he's done here in New York. He's created a tremendous amount of jobs. He's rebuilt so much of the city. It's going to be interesting. I'm looking forward to the debates to see what the other candidates have to say. And, you know, I think we'll all make our decision then.
We're going to enjoy this, though.
Wouldn't you love him in a debate when you watch your stupid fucking debates?
We all love Trump in this room.
How could you not? The guy's got a lot of charisma. He's unapologetic. He has had it up to here with being politically correct. And quite frankly, so have I.
Yeah, everybody.
You know what? It is what it is. Get over it. Whatever your kink is, whatever derivation there is, hey, just accept it. You have to have accountability and move on. I'm so tired of people tiptoeing around issues.
Babying everybody. Yeah. Everybody's a fucking baby.
There's not even the politically correct thing. It's like if he just say what the fuck you mean one time on TV.
It would make everybody's life easier.
No,
I
think because
people appreciate that.
What happens is the language is a weapon against so many people who are underprivileged and don't have the opportunity.
Words are violence.
Well, Trump just knows how to do things. You know, Lindsey Graham, he got into a little pissing match with Lindsey Graham. And, you know, he went down to Lindsey State and asked people if they're pissed off with the way things are handled. And he, like, told everyone, well, then call him. Here's his cell phone.
Yeah, give him the number.
There should be that kind of accessibility to our politicians.
Always.
And he's now saying that was very presidential of him to do that.
And then Lindsey Graham puts his ridiculous video together about smashing his cell phone.
Shut up, Lindsey.
Hell,
you know stick what? Your head in a fucking blender.
I didn't see the video, but that's missing the point of all this.
It's missing the point. Yeah. Hey, you know what? Be accountable. Why don't you stand up for yourself? And I'm not targeting or hitting anyone hard. I'm just saying, look, we all need to be accountable. Yeah. All right.
What did Lindsey Graham? I did not see this. They're probably trying to combat it, like do the.
Well, he's trying to be.
Can we look at this real fast?
Oh, it's
yourself. Is it really a dumb?
I don't know. It's like a comeback video.
All right, let's see.
Let's see the comeback. He's walking. He's got the cell phone.
Right. Seriously?
How to destroy your cell phone with Lindsey Graham.
He's got a
meat cleaver.
Yes.
A blender. A golf club.
Right.
Pouring like Drano on it or something. A samurai sword.
Red Bull.
Dropping a big rock.
This is so big.
He's just destroying it. You know what, though?
He's an idiot, dude.
But at least I'll say this for he's trying to at least make something out of it. Like,
right.
What do you do when that happens? It's like he's just trying to be funny about it. Like, all right, he got me. And
well, the gist of the video is now, finally, I don't have to talk to the people.
No, he's saying this is the lessons.
All else fails, you can always give your number to the Donald. This is for all the veterans.
What the fuck does that mean?
Corn, whack, lame, corn, stupid.
He couldn't even commit to the bit and get a nice cell phone to destroy. You
that's
that?
The cell phone that he uses.
That's what he uses.
You sure that's
the... Yeah, he uses a flip phone.
That's for the
he should have had it destroyed the fucking years ago.
Oh, God.
I wouldn't say that was great, but he's trying to address it. Like,
he's trying to do
you
something.
You know what I mean? Like, how do you address when somebody gives you
a number? Was cool in the 80s to do it.
You know how you address it? You dedicate it to the veterans.
No, he was against the wall.
It just shows they don't have any personality.
Yes, you're a zero.
That's him trying to show personality.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yuck.
How do you have a wife?
A dude? How is he not his own wife with that fucking face and name? Lindsay, come in here. Yes, Lindsay.
Did you enjoy your time on Celebrity Apprentice?
I did. You know, I was funny for my life. It's the hardest thing I've ever done.
Yeah, the jingle thing.
The jingle?
Why couldn't you let it go, man? Why couldn't you let the jingle go?
Why couldn't I let it go?
Yeah.
Why should he?
I've worked in radio for a long time. I've done a lot of radio commercials. I've never, you know, had a radio show. But when I was little, I used to sing Frosted Lucky Charms, The Magic Leaf.
Yeah, delicious.
That was me.
That sound like the commercial.
Oh, that was you in a commercial.
You were singing.
That was actually
like
you?
30 or 40 of these radio spots. I used to like sing jingles when I was a kid. I know what jingles are. There's a hook. They're memorable. They tune people into what you're talking about, and then they continue to resonate, and they continue to resonate. So we had to create a jingle.
Right.
All right. So. Tell me.
You still getting emotional about it, too.
Well,
I like
because,
this.
What was the product for? Because I'm good at this.
What's that?
What was the product?
What was the product?
It was for Bud Light Rita's drinks. Okay.
Okay.
Right, right.
There's Mangoritas, there's right. Raspberitas. Okay. So we had to come up with a jingle. A jingle's short, it's concise. So I came up with, let me see if I can remember it. Raspberita. Mangoritas. Might sound crazy, but it's true.
Yes.
It's the cool thing with a new zing from the king of beers to you. What is that?
Yeah.
That's all right. He loved it so much. Right.
But wait, what are they called?
Wait a second. Wait a second. Ask your viewers. Is that right. a jingle?
What's the product called?
It's like a fruit drink, but Budweiser.
Bud Light Bud Ritas.
Bud Ritas.
Yeah, it's kind of like a malt cocktail drink.
Yeah, see, that yours is good, but I would have probably had something a little catchier. What are they called again? Bud what?
Ritas.
Bud Ritas.
Bud Light Ritas.
Bud Light Ritas.
Like something like, Bud Light Ritas, so many flavors. That's my idea.
Right. I'm going to take you out with Double Cobra. You're fired.
People know how many flavors there are that way. I like that.
Yeah, so many flavors.
Whatever, you know what? I went as far as I was allowed to go on
they
that show.
They shut you down on it. They shut you down on a jingle.
I still feel like I won.
That actually wasn't bad for a jingle, though. It's like, that's what a commercial would sound like.
Yeah.
Well, what did they actually use? What would they end up using?
They went with... it was Brandy Glanville, who just wasn't putting up with any more of my stuff. I was pushing her buttons left or right. She's a train wreck to begin with.
The housewife?
She was easy to...
What does she know about drinking?
Yeah. She knows a lot about drinking. Right.
She knows a lot about the drink.
You know, I raised $320,000 for Epidermolysis bullosa, the Medical Research Foundation.
Is that a black girl's name?
EBKids.org.
Is that a black girl's name?
Oh, it's actually a monstrous disease that is many times fatal to little kids. It's
what is it? Black girls.
Thanks, Sherrod.
So a black girl.
Way to go, Sherrod. What is the disease?
Epidermolysis
bullosa. Yeah. It's a it's a skin disease. I couldn't possibly.
Is that where the skin hardens?
It's where even minor abrasions will cause this burn-like effect on the skin, and the skin just doesn't regenerate.
There's I know what you're talking about.
Deformed keratin molecule, and the skin just doesn't come back. So quite often these babies have to be wrapped for their entire lives. The fingers end up. I mean. No skin.
Was that the boy whose skin fell off? Remember
butterfly.
That show?
They're called butterfly kids. If you search for them on YouTube,
here it is right here.
Every video comes with a warning. Very difficult.
They can't be hugged or anything like that. Isn't that the contact?
You know, some of these kids live on morphine drips just because the pain is so intense.
Oh, you get morphine.
How serious and there's is no this type of thing?
Serious. There's no treatment. There's no cure.
And like how spread is like how
you know it's worldwide kind of overlooked and underfunded because it's not all that.
It's real rare.
It's pretty rare, but enough kids have it that you know money buys science.
Yeah,
science buys life. I figured if I was going to use my celebrity as capital, why not spend it doing something good for someone who could really use it?
Yeah, that's like amazing. The rare diseases, dude.
It's rare.
$320,000 is a lot of fucking money.
Dude, that guy whose balls grew all the way to the ground where he's like sitting.
The black
balls.
Guy. Yeah. He's died.
He died. We have him in
disease,
here.
They also...
What?
Well, if it doesn't kill enough people, it doesn't get the funding. That's a sad fact about this.
Yeah,
like progeria goes through the same thing. The progeria kids.
And Jimmy's still sitting here.
I'm fighting hard.
He's hanging in there.
By the way, all the people that talk about nature and like, you know, this is against nature. This is what nature does, too.
Yes.
Like, nature does weird shit,
What is everyone talking about with that?
With Caitlyn Jenner or whatever. Yeah. People always say, well, what's nature, what's not?
Yeah.
Nature just throws these weird things in. Terrible.
Since when
no
do we get
why?
Air conditioning? Is not nature. Since when do we get?
That's
a why
shit? I don't have it.
Oh,
you don't believe in it.
That's a horrible disease.
Nature makes Sharknado.
That's a lot of money,
so
though.
You can't trust it.
1 in 50,000 births. It looks like.
It's horrible. Right? It's horrible. Yeah. EBKids.org. Check it out.
How old do they live to be?
You know, some live a good long life, but quite often in severe cases, you know, not very long,
and it's painful.
Jesus. Excruciating pain.
No, I saw that. It was called The Boy Whose Skin Fell Off. It was one of those, you know, on Discovery Health, they have those There Is No God shows.
Yeah.
Where they're like, it's him saying to his mom, and his mom's like, if I had to do over again, I would have just got the abortion. She's saying it in front of the kid. Like, I would have got the abortion. Kid's like, yeah, why didn't you? Like, you can see it's like that. He was in that much pain. Yeah, like she was like, it was not for the pain he has to go through all the time. And then I think they took him on in like a glider and he looked happy for like 5 seconds. So it was like massively depressing.
It's so sad. And I sometimes struggle with my kids just to strap them into the car seat or get them to brush their teeth at night. I can't imagine what it would be like to be a caregiver for one of these kids. So
yeah.
That's, you know, I decided to to dig in and do everything I can to raise awareness.
Jingles are not small.
Yeah,
that's why you didn't want to let it go.
It was worth it.
Now I understand why you didn't want to let it go.
I see why their treatment rided on Ian coming up with the perfect jingle. Nine Bud Light Rita doesn't sell, you ain't getting skin.
Nine people per million in the general population have the condition.
That's brutal.
It's just genetic, right? It's not a thing you catch.
It's a genetic rarity, yeah.
So how are they going to figure that one out?
They're going to figure it out.
You know, like I said, money buys science.
And science buys life. Figure it out, right?
Yeah. So they're working. But right now, there's not even a cure, not even a treatment. I know a mother in Connecticut who gives her son baths in a bleach bath every night just to kill the bacteria on his skin. Because that's what they're most vulnerable to infection. The skin is open. Right. Your skin's your first line of defense.
Right.
When you don't have that, you're open to everything.
Oh, man.
So she just was incredibly appreciative for my my efforts. And, you know, it would be great to see something be done.
You're a lot of fun.
Well, thanks, man.
Did you really audition after Bob Barker left?
Yes, I
did. Oh, right, yeah.
Yeah, I had second thoughts about that before doing it, but then I realized, gosh, you know, $8 million a year to start hosting a party.
That's how much that pays?
Ridiculous.
So you offered me that. I'm like, no, I'd rather do radio.
Yeah. It was
$8 million a year?
40 days a year work? Come on.
What?
Yeah, so I kind of changed my tune pretty quickly. Yeah, I'll give it a shot.
Yeah.
It would have been a different show with me. I'm very high energy.
I
would have loved to have done
Drew
it, by the way.
Right
it would have been fun. Host a party twice a day.
Yes.
Make people's lives and give them cars. It's like,
dude. And hang out with those models all day.
Help get their cats spayed and neutered.
Spayed, whatever.
Always a thing?
I bet that stays in the contract, right? You have to say that.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, that's part of the show.
What's his name says it?
Bob Barker.
Does Drew say it?
Drew says it as well. So I bet you that was part of the deal.
$8 million
a year.
Something 40 like that. Days of work?
Don't quote me exactly on that, but it was about that, yeah.
Well, how about if it's half that? It's still an amazing gig.
If it's a quarter of that.
Exactly.
Sign me up.
For 40 days work?
I would do it even if the only people competing were ISIS. I would still do it. Wow.
Man.
What did you do for the audition? Like, what was your process?
I had to do a game. I had to demonstrate that I could host a game, and we had fake contestants, and I walked them through it. I explained what it was, and then we played, and, you know, I had to come up, you know, with things to say along the way. And I walked out thinking, like, damn, I could do this. This would be fun. Didn't go my way. Drew does a great job. Still a big fan of the show. On sick days, you know, when you'd stay home from school,
you
watch The Price is Right.
Oh, of course.
So the show's going to be around forever.
What did they say to you when you didn't get it? What did they say?
They just said, thanks, we're going to go in a different direction, though. And I understand that.
Famous different direction.
I should have that tattooed on me.
You can't be the guy every time, and that's, you know, I accept that. Being an actor, it's part of my life.
Did you go through one round, or did you, like, go to a second phase?
Oh, within the with the audition?
Yeah.
Yeah, we took the game right through till the end.
No, but I mean, it was with a one-day thing?
Like a second audition, third audition, callback?
No.
Okay.
First I had a meeting, they told me, and then I came back a couple days later, and we did it.
He succeeded Bob Barker as host of The Price is Right after receiving an estimated $9 million ban. Maybe they wanted Drew Carey's audience, too, though, because he comes with a built-in audience from
Family Feud.
Didn't Drew Carey host Family Feud or no?
No, but it's like the Drew Carey show. I was just coming off Dancing with the Stars.
Oh, whose line is it anyway type of thing?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, you did Dancing with the Stars,
that's right.
Too.
Yeah, Drew Carey? Right around that time.
Oh, I did.
Who won that season you were on?
Apollo Ohno.
Oh, yeah, he was good. No, that nigga can dance.
He can dance. He's amazing.
He can dance.
Yeah.
And you were on 902 in over 10 years?
Yeah. Never missed a day of work.
What is it like being a
You had hot girls there every day.
For a decade.
I would have slept there.
A decade of
hot girls. Why would you miss a day of work?
And then not to mention the girls who just come and show up and try to see you.
It's like working in a jungle gym. It was just fun. I played every day. I got to be Steve Sanders. And, like, he was a fun character.
Yeah, you had a good character.
He had a good arc. You know, I got to live through all of his exploits, but never had to pay the price of any of it. And I got to go home at the end of the night.
Who was that little boy who played your slave on there, little black kid?
What?
Herbie Hancock's son, who played the slave, your caddy. Who was he? What's his name?
Who's that?
He's not that's not what he really played. The little black kid who was always around you on 90210, Herbie Hancock's son with those nerd glasses, Urkel glasses.
Gary something? Oh,
there was one. That was one episode. That was when we were in the high school.
That's the only one I saw. I said, black kid, turn it up.
Right. Well, you know, Vivica Fox was on the show.
Yeah. She was? Who was she?
Oh, she was Richard Roundtree's daughter on our show.
Right.
Richard played the popcorn king who moved in next door.
That's before she went to Up All Night or whatever on NBC.
See, I know too
Vivica
much.
Vivica was on Up All Night?
Remember that? No, it was a TV show with Dwayne Martin, Patti LaBelle, and Vivica Fox.
Right, right.
Whatever the name that. Oh, I think it was Up All
she
Night.
She just had a birthday, by the way. Happy birthday, Vivica.
See?
How many, what years was that show actually on, the show itself?
90 to 2000.
Okay, so you were there the entire time. The
yeah, whole, that's a good run. Okay.
Hey, don't get off the boat if it's not sinking right, when you're an actor.
That's a good run.
Yeah.
It's a great run.
I used to like that weekly announcer for it, for 902. It was like, Brandon Walsh has always had an easy time fitting in, but tonight, remember that? Like
The narrator?
Yeah, they didn't, yeah. Like the ad, the promos for it.
Oh, yeah,
I don't remember it.
And then, like, Andrea, for some reason, seemed to be 30.
Oh, the low on the glasses?
The socially conscious one. The one's I wanted like, to smash people her are too. Dying, Brandon. Yes.
She reminded me of Freddie from Different World, but like a white version.
Freddie from Different World.
A white version of Freddie from the Different World. Yeah. Wow. I tell you said that. That's hysterical.
Different World.
Brandon tried to make out with her finally, and then she's like, don't do this.
Right.
She hooked up with another dude.
Brandon was, who did Luke Perry play?
Dylan McKellen.
Dylan, right, okay.
Mm-hmm. Y'all got some pussy back then, didn't you? Y'all must have been smashing everything. That's before your wife.
Oh, yeah.
Smashing everything.
You put up numbers?
Well, yeah.
You had a good run. You could have fucked Blossom, probably.
You know, we all kind of believed anything was possible at that time.
I was trying to think of some of the tasties he might have had. He had some tasties back in the 90s.
He probably had some famous tasties.
Some famous tasties.
Famous tasties. Yeah. You ever fuck Shirley Hemphill?
What's happened?
I wouldn't do that with your dick.
Dave Coulier's.
I'm trying to think, like, who was hot
that was
in
the 90s? Show. Like, if you're going to be on a show in the 90s, that there's no better show to be on for a male than that.
That was fucking huge.
If you like girls.
What about Saved by the Bell? You think Saved by the Bell?
No.
They got
those
more
guys had a weird cult following, though, man. That was probably a real ass getter, too. I mean, it's
not for Zach, but not for Screech. Screech was still beating it
off. Now, they'd bang Screech for the, like, just, oh my God, it was Screech. Screech snuck in there enough. Not on your level, but I mean, he probably snuck in there a bunch. Like, Urkel probably got laid.
Oh, he definitely got laid.
Just to bang someone from the show.
Of course they did.
Why am I talking like so adamantly about this?
How do you really feel?
I don't know why I'm so passionate about it. I really shouldn't. It's not my business. It's nothing to do with me.
Wait, Kelly from Saved by the Bell was Valerie on
90210? Yep. She did both shows.
Really?
Ooh, you're somebody double dipped.
Oh, yeah.
Wait.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's right, Kelly. That's right. Yes.
Wait, hold on.
Tiffany
Kelly?
Thiessen.
Yeah.
Oh, Tiffany.
And she has a cooking show now, too.
Yeah.
She's doing it all double this dip.
And Screech went to jail, right?
No, they postponed it.
They postponed it.
Yeah. He was supposed to be on. He was supposed to get him on Race Wars, and then he pulled out the last minute. Like I guess he was doing Bayside High, the musical or something here.
Okay.
And he was like such a pain in the ass from this fucking production that they finally just canned him.
We had him on once. He's a bit scary, to be honest with you. He's over the Screech thing.
I would have had
really
him.
Really doesn't want you referencing it.
Well, then don't cash the checks, nigga. I'm calling you Screech for the rest of your life.
I'm watching the thing.
He's intense.
Sorry, that's who I am.
He's talking about the porno, right? It's like if you watch all his little weird mistakes, like he never once is like, I just fucked up. He's always like, is there some way it's not really his fault? Whatever it is. So, like, I just watch Screech. Every story, it's like somebody else did this to me.
Yeah.
Mm.
I know karate.
I know karate. I will cut a bitch.
Me. A karate man.
He knows some moves.
He knows some moves.
Dustin Diamond knows some moves.
Yeah, he's a martial artist.
He would. Man. He would what?
I know you.
Right?
Wow, look at the eyes.
He would what?
I don't know, but he's been training for years. Listen, you know why?
I would beat him out of his
fair
fucking
enough.
Flesh.
Sherrod, because he's
I know
a vicious
knows
monster.
How, I know yeah. You know how to scrap and you're a vicious monster.
No, I would sit on his chest and cry while
one
I did
time,
it.
Listen, one, time, I one time I remember, no, Buddy Bolton
wow,
I was talking
Sherrod
to.
Wow, Sherrod with those eyes.
This comic we know, Buddy Bolton. This is like years ago. Yeah.
Sorry. I'd rather you call me a nigga.
I think I always
say that.
My ass.
Well, because you know why, Sherrod? Sherrod kind of looks like, this is my girl always says, he looks like on Family Guy when the baby, his teddy bear, he imagines he's a man, Rupert.
Muscular body, but
he looks like a teddy bear head.
Yeah.
So you don't think he's going to be like a horrible, violent person. But, Buddy Bolton first told me, he goes, oh, yeah, no, you don't want to fight. Buddy Bolton told me a story about you punching some guy where, like, he had a flashlight under his chin. He was so, like, scared telling me this story. You were out somewhere with him and you bashed some guy's face and, like, blood flew
when
everywhere.
When this was an off-duty cop who pulled Rachel's strap off of her, like, he was in a bar, and some dude just came over and pulled Rachel's fucking strap off her arm, like a shoulder.
And he was an off-duty cop?
And he was an off-duty cop, and I told him, you better come get this dude.
Punch him back
on
duty.
And he was there with four of the off-duty cops, and I burst his fucking nose open. That's for Rachel. Wow.
Yeah. Is that your wife, girlfriend?
No, she's my roommate. She's another comedian, Rachel Feinstein.
Okay, so yeah, Rachel has another woman.
Yeah, she's a young girl. We in a bar like 2 in the morning.
What was this guy thinking?
He was drunk, and then they all apologized for him and picked him up and took him out. And he's like, we sorry for that. I was like, yeah, you should have got him before it came to that.
Well, Ian's got to go. He's got to go.
He's throwing me out. But I appreciate the time here with you guys.
Good to see you.
No, we're not throwing you out. Your people are...
Yeah,
I got
to go.
We will keep you.
Thank you so much. Take care, guys.
Great seeing you, man.
Hold on. It re-airs at 7 o'clock on Saturday. Saturday.
On Sci-Fi. Oh, yeah.
We'll take a quick break.
Yeah, we'll take a quick break, and we'll, I don't know, do something else next. Yeah,
thanks tons, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, man.
Quickly, Jim Norton at Levity Live this weekend, starting tonight.
Yeah.
We got Kurt Metzger killing it the last 2 days. He's at the Stress Factory this weekend.
New Brunswick, New Jersey.
Starting tonight.
Yeah.
We got Sherrod Small in studio, who knows Dash.
Who's entering the studio.
Who's entering the studio from Ray Donovan.
And you could.
What's going on, man? Dash?
Dash Mihawk.
Yes.
Yes.
I didn't realize you guys premiered July 12th. I didn't realize season 3 started.
Yeah, it
just
started.
Yeah.
I should have, Oh, thank you very much. Okay.
Yes.
How are you?
I'm well. Yourself?
How good, good.
Good to see you, man.
What's up, bro?
I'm good.
How do you know Sherrod?
We used to hang out back in the day on the Upper East Side a little.
See, he tells these stories about all these people he hangs out with, and half the time I think he's making it up, and then a guy comes in, and it's obvious
you
guys have...
I think I know what's going on here. Dash used to sell Coke. That's what I'm talking about.
Coke. Outed already. It's only been a minute.
That's hilarious. People don't know that you do music, too.
Yeah, man.
Yeah, yes, sir. How's it going? Going well?
It's going good. I'm finally putting stuff out. You know, I've been sitting on things for so many years, and my friends and family are like, you know, why don't you just put it out, man? Yeah. You're 40.
Get it out of your
system.
It's
time to get your rap album out at 40. You know?
How many years have you been doing it where you haven't put it out?
I don't know. I remember my first hip hop group. I was 12. So that's like 86.
Wow.
Nice. What was the name of the group?
It was Sam Dash Chris Strictly Devastated.
Nice.
Oh yeah.
Nice.
Oh yeah. We had such gems as Pissing on the Wall, and I mean I can't.
Yeah, Pissing on the Wall.
We were the hit at our junior high school for sure.
And you grew up where?
I grew up in the Meatpacking District.
Oh, okay. Wow! I spent a lot of my adult life there.
That's actually Jim's nickname.
Well, if your adult life was back when, then you like transvestites.
No, never. No transsexuals. It's a total different. Transvestites are pretenders.
Yeah, transvestites are fakers.
Yeah.
How bad was it back in the day in the Meatpacking District? Because they've really changed that whole area.
It's
pretty crazy.
Night and day. It used to be really streets filled with blood and a lot of walkers and crack, and it was better though.
What was that sex club?
It had more character.
Yeah, way more character.
There was a sex club right now where like the Gansevoort Hotel, I think it's called. What was the, there was like a big door.
Underground or something. Yeah.
I never went in it, but I would drive by and go like, I gotta go in there one day, and I just never actually did it.
Yeah, it's a crazy, you know, I went to PS3, which is on Hudson Street, and, you know, Christopher Street in the 80s was pretty bananas.
Yeah, so,
And my parents were like, you know, I'm 5 walking to school. And,
wow.
And nowadays I see, you know, I don't even see a 16-year-old on the subway by themselves. And it's so safe. It's crazy to me.
Yeah.
So was it violent back then, growing up?
Yeah, well, sure. I mean...
When did it get safe? Was it the Giuliani?
Giuliani. Is that really
it? Probably around there it started, right?
When the money started coming into the city, coming back to the city.
Yeah. But you're right. You walk around New York City, you see little kids with nannies, and then like 20-year-old kids or 18, 19. We're the ones in between. Where are those people?
I mean, junior high school, rode the train, you know, so you're talking 11. And then
that's
high school,
I
was 14.
Too.
I would take the last stop in the Bronx to go up to Bronx Science. So, and I don't ever see a 14-year-old kid on a train anymore.
By themselves, never.
No.
You really see them in general.
Yeah, and you don't want to ask out loud on the train. It sounds crazy.
Where's all the 14-year-olds? Come to the train. I don't mean to disturb y'all, but I'm looking for a 14-year-old girl. But
I do not want your money. Yes. I just wish to find the kids' train.
Yes.
If you'll direct me to the kids' train, I'm down on my luck.
I need someone who is blossoming like a flower.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Oh, my goodness.
But yeah, you're right, though. You don't see a whole lot of, you know, you just don't see it as much. I mean, I didn't ride it back then, though. I'm only riding very recently.
We were young, too, walking around New York City. I mean, me and my sister, we were fucking 5, 6 years old, easily. No problem.
Man. And the parents weren't ever nervous about anything. I mean, I know everybody got a little shook when Eton Pates was
kidnapped. That changed the city.
That started to shift it a little bit, but still, even then, you know, they would let us do whatever.
We had more freedom.
Yeah.
A lot more freedom. Yeah, helicopter parents back then.
Kids that grow up here just terrify me.
Oh, it's the best. Nothing beats New York.
Vampires. Like, weirdly mature early.
Yeah, the movies like The Warriors came out. You're like, God. I don't want to go there. It's a scary place.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Were you in the baseball fury?
Yeah, it's a really practical way to be in a gang. Just roller skate around. Yeah. That's a really good way to fight.
I like the Turnbull ACs, the other bad guy.
God,
was that for air conditioners? Why would they call it the ACs?
Maybe, I don't know. Atlantic City?
Turnbull Air Conditioners.
Do you want to know the name of the sex club? Because we got a guy.
Yes, I do.
You really do? Okay, let's go to him quick. Chris in Brooklyn, go ahead.
Okay, Jimmy, I hope it's the same one you're talking about. During the week, it was called Hellfire, and then on the weekends, it was called The Manhole.
Hellfire, I remember that name, and it was like a big thing. I'm glad. I thought it was an S&M club.
Yes, it was.
Okay.
But I believe it was something that. It was something even before
that. The Vault was the sex club, but I never went to The Vault. Me and my buddy Rich Voss went as a goof, but it had moved locations.
When it was on 23rd?
I don't remember.
I think it was on 23rd. The new Gotham is.
Me and Voss rang the bell.
But it was on 23rd.
The elevator came down for us. We go up, and it's just some guy in a robe. It was his apartment. On the weekends, it became The Vault. So it was like me and Rich, and the guy's like, no, it's not open tonight. It was just some guy. We kept ringing the bell.
But why would he let you up if it wasn't open?
Because he wanted to get rid of us. He wanted to get rid of us.
He's like, Ping's Chinese.
That's creepy.
Yeah.
Oh, now it's that nice restaurant.
Yeah, all those sex clubs went away. But now with the internet, you don't need
them. Yeah,
Dos
something.
Caminos, right, yeah.
Yeah.
I've been to Dos Caminos.
They better blacklight that fucking room.
Yeah. Think it's all gone?
It's probably a little less. Still in
there. There's got to be some left in a light fixture.
Oh, my God.
Fucking a little bit of semen and blood mixed in.
Soaks in, it seeps.
Yeah. Wow.
Right. Have fun your next meal there.
I never went to those places. What did you say? So you started acting, did you start going to acting school here in New York?
I didn't. My parents were theater actors, though, so I kind of grew up around it. But I didn't really want to be an actor. I wanted to be a scientist.
I went to
Bronx High School of Science, and then I kind of got sick in my junior year, and they kicked me the fuck out.
What did you?
That's a smart kid's school too. Bronx Science was hard to get in. It's like Brooklyn Tech, Bronx Science.
Yeah, they wouldn't let you be sick for a while.
I couldn't attend school, they wouldn't let me do school by correspondence. I had like Epstein Barr, like a kind of chronic fatigue syndrome. For like a year and a half. I think it was growing, whatever it was, but I was just ill. So they were like, my mom, I'm saying this for you, mom, because she's still fucking pissed off at them. She's like, fuck that Bronx High School Science. She rages when I talk about it.
So where did you go after that?
So I went to professional children's school after that. And then I saw, all these actors are doing stuff by correspondence. And I kind of started to see that, this is something that I might be interested in.
Professional children's school?
Yeah, it's basically... So, a lot of dancers from School of American Ballet go there, and a lot of, child actors that were doing stuff, got shows, and then moved to L.A., they could still do school by correspondence, so.
Where was that school?
That's on, near Lincoln Center.
Okay.
And what kind of science did you want to do? That's an interesting thing to want to do when you're a kid.
I was totally into biochemistry and genetics. I was a real nerd.
You must love what's happening now then with these 3D printers that they're doing. Crazy. And you must, it's pretty amazing, right?
Yeah, that's why I'm coming out with a rap album.
We gotta go back to the vault. We gotta go back to the vault for 1 second.
Okay.
Because they have a then and now. All right. So the vault, a celebrity packed notorious S&M club where gay and straight ditched their clothes and spanked each other. After early success, the club moved to 28th and 10th Avenue.
Okay.
Now it's 675 Bar, a bar you want to go to anytime, all the time. It's where you'll find good company, a comfortable setting, great music, and of course, a stiff drink.
And Dos Caminos, which serves upscale Mexican cuisine. Oh, then in the parentheses, and if you go in the back, they'll shit in your mouth.
So we want to keep tradition alive a little bit. You can still get a little taste of that.
Yeah, right. So they haven't lost all the old flavor.
Now, Ray Donovan, we got to talk about the show. I'm a big fan of the show, man.
You play Ray's brother on the show?
Bunchy.
Bunchy.
Yeah,
how do they explain that you're a redhead and your brother's a Jew?
They don't.
fair enough.
They just don't.
The show's so good.
Thank you.
Yeah, Lee Schreiber's great, man. You're great in it. And John Voight is really good.
Unbelievable.
Yeah, we have a good time. There's a lot of Eddie Marson, great actor.
Yes.
And Paula Malcolmson and Pooch Hall.
He's locked up.
Is Wendell Pearson in this season?
Wendell.
He played a parole officer.
I believe Wendell makes an appearance this season, yes.
He probably will, yeah. Yes,
and you were molested by like a priest as a kid. There's all these
things. Going back to the vault. Yes, I was. I was molested by sexually abused by a priest. So, yeah,
sorry. That's a big push in the story. Kind
that's of. Just part of every Irish boy's life, you know.
Yeah,
we call that the Beantown Bar Mitzvah. Isn't that an episode of Ray Don?
I think that was second season, third episode.
Holy!
Now, are you going to hook up with that the Mexican wrestling girl this season? You can tell me that.
Wait, Maxie,
you want Splash Show fan? I know you are.
Maybe.
That's part of the storyline right now. I mean,
but he's not going to give that away.
She's kind of dominatrix to him, speaking of
yeah,
speaking,
I'm telling you, this is all good conversation.
Oh, wait, is she the one who was with someone else and you went and found out at the house you saw them leaving together?
No.
Is that the different girl?
Oh, that's that's my other brother. That's my other.
Oh yeah, that's right, Terry. Right,
okay,
Terry,
right,
yeah.
Yes,
Now, this is a new season where there's this female Mexican luchadora wrestler who's like kind of staring me down and dominating me a little bit.
Oh, nice.
Uh-huh.
She gave him the middle finger a couple of times when he was staring at her working out, too. It was great.
A good dominating woman can be really sexy.
It's nice and creepy.
If they're not cheesy about it.
She had him scrubbing a shower.
Like my mom was always like
with a toothbrush.
I recently was whacking off. This is off subject for a second, but I was recently whacking off at a girl.
No, it isn't.
You're right. It's right on target. But a girl had her big feet on my face.
Right.
And they smelled good. She had been wearing sneakers. They were sexy. And when the way she was looking at me, just while she played with my nipples and I jerked off like a little chimp. It was so hot. It was her face that got me, though. It was
who does that? That fucking weirdo director. Oh. What, he made that movie Black and White that had Mike Tyson and Robert Downey Jr. in it. What the fuck is his name?
Roman Polanski?
No. He likes to get girl. His whole MO is he's around New York.
I know his name.
James Toback?
James
Toback. So he gets girls. He tells them he's going to put them in a movie. And then they go in the park and he jerks off while they twist his nipples. Like
that's just phenomenal.
I like this guy.
That's phenomenal.
Yeah.
Allegedly.
Oh my God. Let's say that's an allegation. We don't know if it's true. But I hope to God it is. Yeah. I wouldn't even want money to be in this movie.
Right. By the way, I don't even feel bad. If he tells you he's going to put you in a movie and he's like, you just got to tweak my nipples while I jerk off first, I don't feel bad.
Yeah,
for
I'd
you.
Be like, where do you want to put it when you're finishing, sir? which one of my holes is most appealing? All right, why am I saying that? Anyway, so Ray Donovan. How is John Voight? John Voight's an interesting guy because he's not a union guy. Like, he's not in the union, but he still works. Like, he's a very, very rare exception.
I don't know how
he does that. Yeah, it's a pretty
seems
common
like a tough
knowledge.
Thing to do.
He's not
in SAG?
I believe he's not.
How can that work?
I believe he is not.
How can you get
okay to the boards?
I remember hearing about that because he hates the union, unless they made him join. But I remember hearing something about him not being in SAG.
I think he's not very happy with
Republican.
SAG, but he's not.
Travis Hayden's not.
No, there's an article that says he resigned in 2003.
He resigned from SAG in 2003, but he still does projects, I guess, that they have to pay. I don't know how they work. That's how good he
is. I'm reading an article that said Beasts of the Southern Wild was not eligible for SAG awards because he resigned from SAG.
Oh, wow.
So does that hurt the shows that he's in because they're using him?
Who cares about SAG Awards?
I'm just curious. Idea.
I don't understand how he can even work.
It makes me like him. Even
they would send me home if I came and lived
exactly.
I know. Yeah. I get hounded if I don't have my SAG bullshit in order.
He's John Voight.
Yeah.
Well, he's John Voight. Yeah. Do you just do midnight fucking cowboy quotes to him all day? That's all I would do.
No.
Oh, my God.
I'm
you
falling
handsome.
Apart
I try, here. I try not to quote anything he's ever done.
Yeah, that would probably annoy him. Why am I saying that? Maybe that's why you're in a show and I'm not. Because I just quote him.
He'll do it himself. He tells you enough stories.
Did he talk about Midnight Cowboy?
Oh, yeah.
What's
yeah,
he tell you about it? Like, that's not...
Oh, that, like, there's that scene where he falls down the stairs of the hotel.
Right.
Dustin Hoffman, yeah.
And he did the stunt.
Fell down
and did and looked up at the camera and it was like this perfect shot and he did the stunt. He loved to tell that story. Yeah.
That was such a good film. The only X movie ever nominated.
Yeah.
Would be great if he told you a really good story. You know that guy really did give me a blowjob in the movie theater? What?
Allegedly.
You know, I really was dragged out of a barn and raped by cowboys. Is that what happened to him?
Dude, such a bizarre scene that is. Like when he's when in the opening with that chilling, his grandmother's grandma's going to buy you a mock. Mm-hmm. And he's having these flashbacks to this rape.
Yeah, what exactly happened? They fucked him too?
And the girl, they raped him and the girl. It was just a bizarre, horrible experience they had.
So back to Ray Donovan. What?
Yeah. No.
Now, your character is
we're selling the show properly, aren't we?
Yeah. No. I'm just talking about raping and killing and all that stuff. That's what.
No, it's a huge show. Wow. And Lee Schreiber, like I say, is such a great lead.
Oh, it's huge. The show's so good, man. It's so. I love the last season when it ended with Ray and his son dancing to, like, Biggie and some shit.
Oh, yeah, Run-DMC.
Run-DMC. That was fucking great.
Who's your favorite rapper, by the way?
I don't know.
Who would you model yourself after if you had to say there was one rapper?
Sherrod.
Yeah?
I would say Twin Hype.
Twin Hype?
Wow.
That's a great pull.
Oh, Shamik, let's rock.
Wow. I didn't even know that.
They would always house the crowd.
Twin Hype.
I don't know what Twin Hype.
Remember the tic-tac dance? They'd like tap their feet. Yes. Twin Hype? Yeah, I know you remember.
We was talking about this earlier, like being weird around kids. Now, one time in your, like last season, I think you were dating a girl who had a son.
Yeah.
But you felt funny around him because you got molested. Your character got molested by a priest.
You didn't want to take him out of the bath or something.
A lot of people that have been abused, you know, think that they might do it. They don't know. And so Bunchy was unsure whether or not he might want to touch the kid. He obviously wouldn't.
Right.
But the fact that he thought about it was enough for her to say, see you later.
Right.
And I just remember that the scene when we shot it, like there was a mattress and the stunt lady waiting to catch the kid. And
when you threw the kid.
And I threw the kid and the camera was on the ground I just remember this kid jumps on me and then I kind of like, I just let him go and I was like, that did that look good? Because if I would have really thrown him harder. It looked great on camera. I'm like, can I do it again? Because I felt like that was weak sauce. I just kind of dropped him. Like, you should fucking throw the kid on the ground hard.
Yeah.
And everybody's like, no, that you're good.
Yeah, it looked good.
We'll move on to the next shot. It looked like a hard hard throw.
Yeah. Was all camera magic.
It's weird what they address in that show, though.
Is he called Bunchy because that's how much he got molested?
A bunch of
your guess is as good as mine.
Why do we keep taking Bunchy back there?
They used to call him shitloads.
Yes. Yeah. Hey, I lots of times. No, that's not a good one.
You'd rather be called Oncey, right?
Well, yeah, exactly.
And also, is the show based on that private eye that got arrested who was helping spy on everyone's phone calls?
Pelicano?
Yeah. Is it kind of based on him a little bit or no?
I would say it's based more on the guys who used to work for the studios back in the day.
Oh.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
I think it's more.
Oh, they had guys that went out and fixed
guys
the problems?
Fixed problems, yeah.
That worked for
the studios. They still got those guys, studios. I believe.
They do. It's more about that. And it's also the family, some of them were modeled after some people that Ann Bitterman, who created it, knew. I know I believe that I was kind of modeled after her brother.
Oh.
So I don't know what allegedly happened or anything in their life, but she, you know, was very close to her.
So these fixers would go out and just take care of whatever problems the actors were having.
Yep.
And they would, wow. There's a scene in the first season, I think it's season one, where there's a basketball player and this girl blows him. And then she's like, just gonna spit the cum, but he doesn't, he's not, he's like all zoned out, and she spits it into this thing and puts it in the ice bucket. And he's like, I'm gonna go out and get some drink. He's like, okay. And then outside is the chauffeur to the limo waiting, and he takes the cum, which is in the ice, and he leaves so they can put the cum in a girl.
Several
and
she girls.
Can claim his baby. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's a, and I guess that stuff might happen. It's
absolutely happens.
Is it viable if you keep the sperm in your mouth for that
Yeah, I guess so. I guess so.
Freeze it. Is it really temperature?
Sperm are like fucking sharks in space. Like, they could just survive.
Yeah, they survive everything. Ian Ziering has a movie coming out with sperm.
Oh.
It's Cumnado. It's in 3D. They hand out fucking goggles and fucking
splash guards.
Yeah, straws.
Ponchos. Everybody's going to get poncho. Right. Straws.
So, yeah, I didn't know that that happened, but then he goes and he fixes it with the limo driver, but I guess that that's a what a smart people are smart.
I'm
people
sure that has happened.
Smart,
yes, they are
to a celebrity or two.
So
oh,
you,
yeah,
I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure someone's got knocked up at
some of the NBA guys.
Wait, right? Dash, you have Tourette's? I'm looking at the sheet.
I do.
Oh, but geez, it doesn't have you.
I have Tourette's, but Tourette's doesn't have me.
There you go.
It's one reason why you got into acting. I know that much.
Do you take anything for it?
I don't anymore. You know, luckily, in a lot of cases, when you become an adult, a lot of times it subsides a bit, so I don't need to take any, because it always bothered me anyway, the medication. The problem is when you're a kid is when it's really brutal, usually, and that's when kids are really brutal. So I took some when I was in school.
What did it make you do? What did the medication do to you?
Oh, just zombie like, and you know, couldn't really, you know, socially sort of inept. I gained weight, the different shit. We
tried
everything.
They don't have any medicine for stuff like that, because they have no idea how that shit works. They just lobotomize you with medicine.
Well, they don't know. You know, it's a chemical imbalance, right? So it's similar to taking antidepressants and trying to find what the good cocktail is.
Now, did you use to curse people out, like, when you had...
No, I mean...
Are you all better now? That, penis that's... fart dildo?
That's the... Come NATO.
Yeah, that's a fun one to say, isn't it? Come NATO just rolls right out, and there's a hard end sound, which makes it very satisfying to say. Yeah. I understand.
Don't bring Dan's condition back with the best Tourette's
word. Hey, look, I blink like a maniac. Trust me, I'm a mess, too, so I have a mild touch
I
myself.
I think everybody has some sort of OCD in them, and so you can relate. But no, you know, a lot of people do not curse, and that's just what we like to sensationalize. You know, it's a small percentage of people that actually do the loud.
My boy John Bush used to have a joke about Tourette's. He was like, how come Tourette's is always like, fuck, shit, ass? It's never nice, like, nice sweater.
It can be.
Like your pants.
No, but I like that they have to say things that are different just so they don't get punched. Like, if they're around bunch of black people, you hear the guy go, Nichols! Nichols!
You know what? I know somebody who had to say... The real, you know, there are people that had to say
word,
and they can't help it. Yeah.
And do they have to explain it to people before they get beat up? Like, look, I'm not.
Well, you should, because the more you tell people, the more accepting they will be.
Can I just explain to the audience now that I have Tourette's before I launch into this? Now, Sherrod, there's something.
A bigger tirade.
Look at my tirade.
Yes, listen, there's something I've been meaning to say over and over.
I've been holding this in all my life.
Thanks, Tourette's.
Do you prefer people to ask you questions or wouldn't I?
Oh, shit.
What? With Tourette's, people, like, a lot of people, people just ask me.
I would love people to ask me.
As opposed to just wondering or looking, like, when something...
Well, now I don't care, you know? If I'm, like, on a plane and I'm disturbed, you know, because that's the torture. The torture is, look, I don't want to disrupt anybody else's experience around me, you know? I always sit in the back row of a movie theater, you know? I just, that's what hurts the most. I don't want to F with anybody else. So, if I sense that somebody's really uncomfortable, I'll tell them, hey, man, this is what it is, and I can't help it, and I'm really sorry if it's bugging you.
What do you do? Like, what's your actual thing?
My tics, the tics wax and wane, too, so you pick up different ones. The one that I have kept all my life, which it's very strange, is I have to look at a light that's, like, over the side of my nose, and then, like, shaded in by blinking, and I've done this since I was a kid forever. It's even more specific than that, but
I don't want to know it because now I'm going to pick it up.
I'm in the worst freaking business because it's like 10K lights around me all day, every day, and they're like, okay, roll sound. I'm like,
it's very comforting.
And then they're like, action, and I do my thing, and then they're like, cut, and I'm like, oh, okay, I'm going to get it.
But they probably think, like, oh, this guy's a real thinking actor. Yes. Like, every scene, he's like looking up. This guy's got Brando. Like qualities.
And then when you get it just right, then you're okay for a while? Is that how it works?
Exactly. You're basically.
So it's kind of an OCD. It's definitely connected to OCD.
Absolutely. Absolutely. There's a nerve ending. Like, with a lot of times you have to touch things. I have to touch, like, a specific nerve ending in my epidermal layer or whatever of my finger. And until I get that, like, on the corner of the thing I'm touching. And it triggers, goes back to my brain and says, you got it right. I have to keep doing it.
Wow. I do this with my nail where you take the nail and you like, you'll just touch the, in between like my thumb to the middle finger. It just, I don't know. Why am I doing this? Ah, feels right. Good.
Is that a Tourette's thing? Cause I have this thing where I like very small children sexually. Is that, hold on. Is that Tourette's?
It's in the family.
I hide it.
It's in the wheelhouse.
Tomato.
It's in the wheelhouse.
Yes, it is. Tomato. Whenever you're doing that, you just start yelling, Subway sandwiches. Naughty, naughty boy. Was there someone on the phone?
No, we got to get Dash out of here.
Okay.
He's a busy man. I've been told he's got to go.
Oh, Travis is nodding yes. Okay.
Good to see you, man.
Right,
we got to hang out while you're in town.
I'm here till Tuesday.
I bet.
Let's plug properly. Let's plug. Okay. It's on. What night is the show on?
Sundays at night.
9 o'clock on Showtime. And it's Diz Mihawk on, it's at DizMihok.
Yeah.
When's the album coming out?
Later in the summer.
What's
later
it called?
It's amazing.
The album, I'm not sure yet.
I mean, untitled.
But the single is called Love, and we're going to drop that in a couple weeks. It's got cameos by a bunch of my friends and some of my Ray Donovan family. So, Diz and the Fam is the band.
Okay.
Cool. Nice.
Yes, sir.
And awesome. I'm at Levy Live tonight, tomorrow, Saturday, and my special hits Netflix tonight.
Beautiful.
Contextually inadequate.
I think it's up there already on Netflix.
It probably is. I don't know. I haven't checked.
I got a screen cap from one of the Stangles. They said it's up there already.
Oh, good. Okay, so it's on Netflix now.
Yeah, go there now and get Jim Norton special.
Yeah.
None.
Kurt, where are you?
Stress Factory, New Brunswick.
Cool.
That's it?
7:45.
I'll be here in the city all weekend, baby. Comedy Cellar, Comic Strip.
And I do believe you could take Screech. I just want to
and beat him.
Make sure that people know that. I was trying to say that Screech doesn't play. We've had him on the show.
He says Screech does karate. Like that.
But
means
then
something.
I was ready to say he could take you, Sherrod. Sherrod's, he could be a problem.
Sherrod thought there
be.
Was possibly a scheduled fight with Screech. Like, you got it set up?
Yeah. And he got insulted. His neck turned around. I think he pulled something. Because he gave me a look like, are you fucking...
His face changed. Yeah.
But I didn't get the part out that he knows martial arts, this Dustin Diamond.
Well, he doesn't like being compared to anybody who is weak on TV. Like, when we supply that Gary Coleman would beat you at dominoes. You remember how mad you got?
Yes. I'm the one who put him in that sneaker box and buried him.
I now believe you can take Screech. Okay?
Yeah. Oh, yes.
All right.
Thank good.
I spoke too soon on that one.
I needed that hope.
I guess we're done?
Yeah, man. Yeah. See you guys Monday.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for having me.
Thank you, man.